الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى we're going to go through 40 حديثا، 40 hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To be precise, it's 42 hadiths. And as you all know, the hadith, if they are 42, they are rounded off to what? 40. Al-Imam al-Nawwi's 40 hadith is how many? 42. And it's called what? Arba'un al-Nawawiyyah, the 40 hadith of Al-Imam al-Nawwi. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through 42 hadiths. Each and every one of those hadiths, inshallah ta'ala, it contains in it fundamental matters. And we're going to extract from it some of the benefits that are in it. We will not be able in any way, shape or form to extract all of the rulings from these hadiths, because time will not allow it. You can imagine 42 hadiths is a lot. And to finish it in 4 hours is very little. Or 5 hours is very little. These 42 hadiths were gathered and collected not by myself, but by my teacher, who recently came and he visited me here. He's the one who gathered these 42 hadiths. And I haven't personally come across, or I have not seen anyone write in 42 hadiths like this. I have seen 40 hadiths on women, but I haven't seen 40 hadiths that were handpicked and chosen in this manner. And I'm not saying that because he's what? Because he's my teacher. But I'm saying that because of what I honestly believe. Before I start, there are principles that we all have to agree on. If we don't agree on these principles, we're going to have problems. So inshallah ta'ala, note these principles down. These usul and dawabid, principles, foundations. And I would want each and every one of you to memorize these principles. Once we take these 6 principles, once we tackle each hadith, it will make a lot of sense to you. And you won't have a problem inshallah ta'ala. So note these 6 principles down. Write it down in the beginning of your book. You have an empty page, write it down, inshallah ta'ala. Number one, principle number one is every single one of us should know with certainty. The first principle is every one of us should know with certainty that the rules of Allah and the judgments of Allah is the best and the greatest. Allah's judgments, Allah's rulings are the best and the most noble. That's why Allah said in the Quran, وَهُوَ خَيْرُ الْحَاكِمِينَ. Allah is the best of ones who judge. This has to settle in our hearts, brothers and sisters. There's no one's judgment better than Allah Azza wa Jalla. Why? Because Allah's judgment, it contains in it what? وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. Two characteristics Allah's judgments has. It's truthful and it's just. It is what? It's just. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah also says in another ayah, إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ أَمَرَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا ذَلِكَ الدِّينُ الْقَيِّمُ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah referred to this religion as what? ذَلِكَ الدِّينُ الْقَيِّمُ. It's the best, the greatest form of religion. This is the best religion. Why? Because Allah is the one who judged. Humans are biased. When they judge something, they look at their own benefit first. Like in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala observes what? What's good for you. This we all have to agree on. We all have to agree
that Allah Azza wa Jalla's ahkam is the best. Do we all agree on that first one? Yeah. No question. We move to the second one now. We move on to the second one. Is that we need to accept. We also not have to only accept, but affirm that our happiness, our honor, our nobility is connected to obeying Allah Azza wa Jalla. We have to accept and affirm that our prosperity and our success is deeply connected to the obeying of Allah Azza wa Jalla and following His ahkam, His rulings. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the ayah, إِن تَجْتَنِبُوا كَبَائِرَ مَا تُنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ نُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ وَنُدْخِلْكُمْ مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. If you stay away from the sins, and if you stay away from disobeying Allah, what does Allah do? Allah says in the ayah, نُدْخِلْكُمْ, we will enter you into مُدْخَلًا كَرِيمًا. We will enter you into a good place. Meaning in this world, you will enjoy yourself. And in the hereafter, Jannah awaits you. مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. If you follow what Allah tells you to do, and you stay away from what He told you to stay away from, you would live a what? A joyful life. Allah is promising you here. And wallah, we need to understand, وَلَا يُنَبِّئُكَ مِثْلُ خَبِيرٍ. No one is going to inform you the way Allah is. And no one will tell you what it really is better than Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah is saying to you, you will live a good life. And the opposite is true. Which is what? When you turn away from Allah's rules, and you think that other constitutions, or you think your culture, or you think your personal thoughts is better than the laws of Allah, then you will live a very hard and painful life. You will suffer. You will be running from one consultation session to another. All because what? This was not what was good for you. Look at the story of the man who Allah mentioned in Surah Yasin. What did Allah tell us subhanahu wa ta'ala? That the man came to his people and he said to them, إِنِّي آمَنْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ فَاسْمَعُونَ. I believed in your Lord. I believed in our Lord. Listen to what I have to tell you, he said to them. Take from me that good is in following Allah. The man, they didn't listen to him and he died. Allah tells us it was said to him, قِيلَ دُخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ. Enter Jannah. Enter what? Jannah. Why did he enter Jannah? Because he said, إِنِّي آمَنْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ فَاسْمَعُونَ. قِيلَ دُخُلِ الْجَنَّةِ. And then look what he said. He said, قَالَ يَا لَيْتَ قَوْمِ يَعْلَمُونَ بِمَا غَفَرَ لِي رَبِّي وَجَعَلَنِي مِنَ الْمُكْرَمِينَ. He said, I wish that my people who I left behind, they knew what I received. And he mentioned what? بِمَا غَفَرَ لِي رَبِّي. My Lord had forgiven me. وَجَعَلَنِي. And Allah made me مِنَ الْمُكْرَمِينَ, those who He honored. Then following Allah's religion and adhering to the deen of Allah honored me, he said. وَجَعَلَنِي مِنَ الْمُكْرَمِينَ. So what are you looking for? Honor? Are you looking for respect? Allah respects and honors the one who follows His religion. So that's something we have to accept and digest and place in our hearts. Allah also says in the ayah, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Allah told us, prosperity, أَفْلَحَ, فَلَاح is prosperity. Success is for who? مَنْ زَكَاهَا, the one who purifies himself. From what? Three things, shirk, bid'ah, and ma'asiyah. He purifies from his heart, shirk. He purifies from his heart innovation. And he purifies his heart from disobedience of Allah. What is he going to receive? Falah, success. وَقَدْ خَابَ, and destruction is for who? مَنْ دَسَّاهَا, the one who taints his heart. With doing what? Shirk. And doing what? Bid'ah. And doing what? Ma'asiyah, disobeying Allah Azza wa Jalla. The third principle that we all have to agree upon is, the third principle that we all have to agree on is every single one of us, when we were created, starting from the creation of Adam, that day an enemy started for us. The day Allah created Adam, and Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala told everyone to prostrate to Adam. And the angels, Allah said, فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ. Angels, all of them prostrated. أَجْمَعِينَ, all of them. One individual refused to prostrate. And this was Iblis. He refused, and he became an enemy from that day till today. You now have to ponder, brothers and sisters, this enemy, his enmity started that day. And he made a covenant and a promise with Allah. He said, لَأُهْوِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. I am going to misguide them all. In another ayah he says, وَلَأُضِلَّنَّهُمْ وَلَأُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ وَلَأَمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُبَتِّكُنَّ آذَانَ الْأَنْعَامِ وَلَأَمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ يَتَّخِذِ الشَّيْطَانَ وَلِيًّا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ خَسِرَ خُسْرَانًا مُبِينًا يَعِدُهُمْ وَيُمَنِّيهِمْ وَمَا يَعِدُهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. Iblis made a promise to Allah. He's talking to Allah directly. He says, وَلَأُضِلَّنَّهُمْ. Every single one of them, I'm going to misguide them. وَلَأُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ. I'm going to place false hopes in their hearts by telling them they're going to receive freedom and liberation. I'm going to lie to them. I'm going to glorify things for them. وَلَأُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ وَلَأَمُرَنَّهُمْ. I'm going to command them. Iblis is saying this. What is it that he's going to do to them? I want you to underline what it mentions in the ayah. وَلَأُضِلَّنَّهُمْ وَلَأُمَنِّيَنَّهُمْ وَلَأَمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُبَتِّكُنَّ آذَانَ الْأَنْعَامِ وَلَأَمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ. Underline this. They are going to change how Allah created them. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَى رَجُعُونَ. So Iblis is going to work towards changing the way that you look. Na'am. He's going to make the woman pluck her eyebrows. He's going to make her what? Change the way Allah made her look. It's going to make the men. There's some men that do makeup in this time that we're living in. There are men who do some of the things that women do. And this is true. وَلَيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ. I will make them change the way Allah created them. Do you know why Shaytan wants you to change the way Allah created you? Because it was the creation of Adam what took him out of Jannah. And it's that same creation he wants to humiliate. It's that creation that took him out of Jannah and told him and made him leave Jannah. And so today, what's more greater for him than to see the creation drunk, falling on the ground and sleeping inside their vomit? This is the creation he was told to prostrate to. For him, there's honor to see them humiliated like this. وَلَآمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُبَتِّكُنَّ آذَانَ الْأَنْعَامِ وَلَآمُرَنَّهُمْ فَلَيُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ. Look what Allah says. وَمَنْ يَتَّخِذِ الشَّيْطَانَ وَلِيًّا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. Anyone who takes shaytan as a close ally besides Allah, and takes shaytan as his close ally, فَقَدْ خَسِرَ خُسْرَانًا مُبِينًا. This person is truly in clear misguidance. Shaytan is not going to give you what is prosperous for you. He's not going to tell you the path to Jannah. He's going to take you away from Jannah and bring you close to the hellfire. So we need to believe that. But you know what people don't understand? They think the shayateen are only shayateenul ins. What do they think? The shayateen is the only, jinn. They think it's the jinn. They think the only shaytan is Iblis and he's jinn. La. Allah tells us in the Quran, there are وَإِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ لَيُوحُونَ إِلَىٰ أَوْلِيَائِهِمْ لِيُجَادِلُوكُمْ فَإِنْ أَطَعْتُمُوهُمْ إِنَّكُمْ لَمُشْرِكُونَ. Allah tells us that the shayateen al jinn, they send revelation to the shayateen al ins, and they're the ones who propagate, we're here to take women out of the shackles of religion, out of the shackles of oppression, and we want to liberate them and give them freedom. Huh? These are shayateen al ins. What do they want to do? Take the women out of the what? The households, and bring them out. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَ تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَى. So the man leaves the house and the woman leaves the house. Both of them are outside. The children are at home. Who's nurturing and cultivating the children? The television. The Western televisions are the ones who are nurturing the children. Father's outside running around bringing rizq. And the mother is outside her. She's working and she's... And they come home. They don't know each other. They don't have relationship. They don't understand each other. And the children are in their own world as well. Three parties are in the house. The children, the mother and the father. Sah. So this is what shaitan wants for you. This is the haqa'iq and the reality. Number four. The fourth asal that we have to agree upon is that tawfiq, the ability to be upon the true way, the ability to be upon what is haq, and your matters becoming correct, and your affairs being steadfast, is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, we cannot be guided except if Allah wishes for us to be guided. That's what Allah said in the Quran, وَمَنْ يُهِنِ اللَّهِ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ مُكْرِمٍ. If Allah humiliates a person, there's no one to honor them. And if Allah chooses to honor a person, there's no one to what? To disgrace him. There's no one who can help you, whichever decision Allah makes for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِذَلِكَ guidance is in where? Where is the guidance in? The guidance is present in Allah's religion, and it's in the hand of who? It's in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِذَلِكَ the messenger used to say, Allahumma, O Allah, أَصْلِحْ لِي دِينِي. O Allah, perfect my deen for me. وَأَصْلِحْ لِي دُنْيَايَ. And perfect my dunya for me. Who did he used to ask? Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah, perfect my religion for me. Guide me. And also what? O Allah, perfect my worldly affairs for me. The poet, he said, مَنْ اِهْتَدَى بِهَدِيهِ فَقَدْ ظَفِرْ وَمَنْ يَحِدْ عَنْ نَهْجِهِ فَقَدْ خَسِرْ تُلْفِي بِهِ إِلَى الْفَلَاحِ مَخْرَجًا وَعَنْ جَمِيعِ الْمُعْضِلَاتِ مَخْرَجًا فَلَيْسَ خَيْرٌ قَطٌ إِلَّا قَرَّرَهْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ مِنْ شَرٍ إِلَّا حَذَّرَهْ فَدِينُنَا لَمْ يَخْلُ عَنْ حُكْمٍ عَلَى مَرِّ الزَّمَانِ لَوْ بَدَى مَا أَعْضَلَ لِأَنَّهُ قَدْ احْتَوَى قَوَاعِدَ تُسْتَخْرَجُ الْأَحْكَامَ عَنْهَا رَاشِدًا. مَنْ اِهْتَدَى بِهَدِيهِ فَقَدْ ظَفِرْ. Anyone who follows Allah's guidance, he has reached the goal. وَمَنْ يَحِدْ عَنْ نَهْجِهِ فَقَدْ خَسِرْ. Anyone who diverts from it, loss. تُلْفِي بِهِ إِلَى الْفَلَاحِ مَخْرَجًا وَعَنْ جَمِيعِ الْمُعْضِلَاتِ مَخْرَجًا. If you go every time a problem happens in your household and you go to the Quran and the Sunnah, wallahi, you have an answer there. Allah hasn't left anything behind. Is it possible Allah created us and then he forgot the manual guide that's going to guide us? For you to say, I couldn't find an answer in the Quran and the Sunnah, is attributing to Allah ignorance. And it's attributing to Allah that he didn't tell you a path for prosperity. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَا مِن نَبِيٍ بَعَثَهُ اللَّهِ. There is not a prophet that Allah sent down, إِلَّا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ حَقًّا أَن يَدُلَّ أُمَّتَهُ عَلَى خَيْرِ مَا يَعْلَمُهُ لَهُمْ. There's no prophet that came from the time of Nabi Allah Adam till today. No prophet came except that it was upon him to guide his people to the good that he knows. That prophet's job was to guide his people to every good that can take them to Jannah. And every harm that can harm them, that prophet came to tell them, stay away from it. There's a harm in this for you. So guidance is in whose hands? It's in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's hands. Number five, make your ultimate aspiration to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't make your ultimate goal to please an individual, an organization. Don't. Make your ultimate goal to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A lot of sisters who would follow the deen, they don't because they are scared because of what others may say, or a cousin what he would say, or family relatives, what are they saying about my hijab and the way that I dress and the way I hold them to my deen? Don't worry. The honor, where is it? It's in the hands of Allah. Please your Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone who tries to please the creation, that which angers the creator, Allah will finally make the creation hate you, and Allah is going to hate you. Trying to please the people is a goal you're never going to reach. Wallahi, you won't. رِضَ النَّاسِ غَايَةٌ لَا تُدْرَكْ. Pleasing the people is a goal you're never going to reach. If you please these people, there's another group you can't please. Who's it that you need to please? Allahu Azza wa Jalla. It's him that you need to please. And the most honorable person to Allah is what? Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. The one who has piety. That's all you need to focus on. Number six, and the last one is, this is specific to sisters, that the ahkam that the Sharia has given to you specifically, the ahkam was tailored and it was cut for women, some ahkam that weren't for men, and ahkam that were made for men and not for women. Are we all together, brothers? We're going to learn some rulings that are specific to sisters. The woman has to know and she has to understand these ahkam that we're mentioning. It is in accordance to her creation. What did I just say? The hukum, the ruling, is in line with your creation. And the ahkam for the men is in line with their creation. And the creation of the man and the woman is different. I hope that doesn't require me to prove that. That the creation of men and women are different, true or false? If a man and a wife are walking together and the wife is carrying all the shopping and he's walking next to her, what would you say? That he's a good man? Yeah? As a question, what would you say? Huh? But what about if the man is carrying everything and the woman isn't? Is that bad? That's normal, huh? That's what's expected from you, huh? The point is, the reason is because the people who are making these ahkam have tailored it. I mean, the hukum was tailored in what? In accordance to the essence of the man and the essence of the women. So I want you to all realize, brothers and sisters, Islam did not come to fulfill fairness. Our religion's got nothing to do with fairness. It doesn't observe fairness. Are we all together? It observes justice. Our religion does not observe equity and equalness in things. It doesn't observe that. It observes justice. And there's a difference between the two. Not everything that's equal is justice. Why? If I ate a burger and I gave that same burger to a newborn baby, is that fair? But that's equal. I ate a burger and so did the newborn baby eat a burger. But is that fair? Is that justice? It's equal, but it's not justice. And then Islam came to observe what? Justice. It came to observe adl. This concept of equity, eliminate that term. It's nothing to do with the Quran or the Sunnah. Adl. Are we all together? Now, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to start these 42 hadiths and we're going to extract rulings out of it. Men and women can benefit, inshallah ta'ala. بإذن الله الكريم. الحديث الأول, the first hadith. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, من عال ثلاث بنات عن أبي سعيد الخدري. أبي سعيد الخدري, he narrated that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من عال ثلاث بنات, anyone who cares for three daughters, فَأَدَّبَهُنَّ. I want you to underline each point I mentioned. فَأَدَّبَهُنَّ. He disciplines them, number one. وَزَوَّجَهُنَّ. And marries them off. وَأَحْسَنَ إِلَيْهِنَّ. And is good to them. فَلَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. That person will receive Jannah. This issue of daughters is a specific ruling to daughters, not to the son. Men cannot say, oh, this is not fair. And they make a men's movement. Men's liberation movement. And say these ahadith are oppressing us. La, this is a hukum unique for who? It's unique for the women. specific for their gout. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, anyone who what? Who cares for three daughters. We're going to see less than that, which is two. The Shaykh is going to bring the next hadith. What does he do? He cares for the girl. He disciplines her. What does it mean, disciplines her? It means whatever rulings he taught her, he observes that she's following it. After he's taught her, this is how you eat. This is what you can eat. This is how you pray. This is how you fast. When he teaches his daughter, he's overlooking her. Are we all together? Here is not just tell your children, Allah's fear Allah, and just walk away. It involves observing them, overlooking them, seeing are they following it. He does that. Okay. فَأَدَّبَهُنَّ وَزَوَّجَهُنَّ. So, مَنْ عَلَى جَارِيَتَيْنِ. He cares for her. Cares for her, what does it mean? It means he does three things. It means he does three things. He shows his daughter affection. Number two, he shows his daughter appreciation. And three, he shows his daughter attention. Three A's, huh? Affection. He's very affectionate towards his daughter. He gives her good names. My princess. وما إلى ذلك. That he calls her that. To be affectionate to her. Appreciation is that when she does something, he doesn't go hard on her. He's a bit, because of her taba, her nature. That doesn't mean she doesn't get disciplined. She gets disciplined. Okay? But she showed appreciation. The third one is attention. The father doesn't just dismiss his daughter and busy himself with his phone, messaging. Or using that. وَلِذَٰلِكَ statistics has shown girls who do not receive this from a father or a male figure in her household, the statistics have shown the rate of going for prostitution is very high. When a girl doesn't receive that and doesn't get it from her father and her brothers and those who are closest to her, statistics has shown of what has been stated, and our religion has told us this before. So a father should go and show good manners towards his daughters. وَلِذَلِكَ our Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم was like that towards his what? His daughter, Fatima رضي الله تعالى عنها. He said, فاطمة بضعة مني. I'm a بضعة مني. Fatima is a part of me. Whoever loves her, loves me. And whoever hates her, hates me. The Messenger said this, عليه الصلاة والسلام. When Fatima came to, but I want you to remember this. If it comes to religious issues, you're strict with your daughter, that doesn't mean you're bad to her. When Fatima came to the Prophet's house, and she asked about the Prophet, and Aisha said, he's not here, but when he comes, I will tell him that you were looking for her. So Aisha, Fatima went. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came home, and he was told that his daughter Fatima came. He didn't even sit down. Straight away he went to her. And when he came, he saw Fatima and her husband Ali ibn Abi Talib. The Messenger sat in between them. And he looked at them and he said, what is it that brought you both? And then Fatima said, Ya Rasulallah, I heard that you have slave girls. Maid, slave. I want you to give me some because I want to use them to help me in the house, in the chores. And then she showed the Prophet ﷺ the splits in her hands and the cuts. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, loving his daughter, he looked at her and he said, shall I tell you something better than the slaves that you're asking me for? She said, of course. Because he wants Jannah for his daughter. He wants Akhirah, he wants a great place for her. And she said, of course, O Prophet, tell me, Father. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, do the adhkar, subhanallah 33 times, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, Udi 33 times. Ali ibn Abi Talib said, when I heard that from the Prophet, because he was there sitting, he said, I never left it. I never what? I never left it. The narrator said, even the day when you were fighting with the Khawarij, the day that the fitna was happening, with the Khawarij, when you're fighting with the Khawarij, did you, the Khawarij, Nahrawan, when he was fighting with the Khawarij, did you forget this? He said, wallah, I even didn't forget it that day. I made my dhikr that day. I never left it. So this shows you that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't become emotional with her situation. He gave her what was what? Better for her. He prescribed for her what? He prescribed for her that which was better. Salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. وَزَوَّجَهُنَّ And he marries his daughter off. The daughter who she married off to, a man that's good for her. That's the right that your daughter has on you. You don't marry her off to a man who's got a lot of money because you, father, expect to get money from the father, this man. You marry off the person to your daughter, which is who? The best person that you think is fit for her. فَلَهُ الْجَنَّةِ Anyone who does that, he has Jannah. Why is this what specific to the women? Because before Islam, women had no value, no status. Allah says in the ayah, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ضَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ If his wife gave birth to a daughter, his face will become dark and he will become stressed and worried. يَتَوَارَ مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ When he sees a person from the community, he would hide from them behind trees. يَتَوَارَ meaning يَخْتَفِي He hides. He can't face the community, so he's hiding from the gatherings where the people sit. Because they're going to say to him, oh, you know this man? He's got a daughter. His wife gave him a daughter. How low it was seen as. يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ Why? Because of the evil that was promised to him. He thinks of two things only. أَيُمْسِكُوا عَلَى هُونٍ Shall I hold on to my daughter with disgrace? عَلَى هُونٍ Disgrace. And be humiliated by holding after, looking after her. And be called the man who has the daughter. Disgrace for me, he thinks. أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ Or shall I take her and bury her alive? And if I do bury her, when do I bury her? And how do I bury her? That's all he would think of. Islam, when it came, it honored, and it venerated women, and the position that Islam gave, it's what's justice. Beyond that is injustice. Below that is injustice. Because we already took whose hukum is the best? Allahu Azza wa Jalla. Allah chose this for the women. So whatever Allah chose for you is the best. If you look at the concept, because in university I study linguistics, language shift, how language changed. How language shifted in advertisement, when they advertise things. If you look 100 years ago, the advertisement of powder, liquid powder, washing clothes, it was a woman that would do it. She would be washing the clothing, and it was a woman. We have bold two-in-one, and Persil, and etc. It was a woman. As time moved on, it's a brother. So it's a man. He comes and he's got the powder, and the woman's there. She's telling him, I'm going to work. It shifted. Why? The reason it shifted is because political gain. When the World War II happened, the men left. Financially, the government was going down. And in order to get money, they told the women to go and work. And so women started to work. The war now is over. The men are coming back. They realize they have an opportunity to make the men and the women both work. So what did they do? They pushed the women for them to say that the men are trying to oppress us and keep us in the house. Because the government wants to make money from who? Both parties. Are we all together? This is the waqi'. No one cares about the woman. In the UK till today, the wages that is given to the women are less than the wages given to the men. Till today. Did you know that? Did any one of you, the ones from the UK, know it? But those who are not from the UK, did you know that? That the salary for the women is less than the salary of a man. Why? Is it fair that they can observe the essence of the woman? And if you ask them, they'll tell you, the women, the reason why we give them less is because they have postnatal leave. When they have birth, we have to let them go. And so they've got 40 days and etc. where they can leave. Times when they can't do work properly because of the yearly cycle, monthly cycle. Their work ethics, they believe, it goes down. They did their calculation. If they're right or wrong, that's up to them. The point is, لكن, they observed the woman's creation and then they gave the salary in accordance to that. They passed their hukum. Is it fair that they can do it and Allah Azza wa Jalla can't? Are we all together? The one who created the creation, men and women, he cannot say this is for the women and this is for the men. فَتَنَبَّهُ. Be alert on this issue. Anas ibn Malik, the Shaykh brought the second hadith. And Anas ibn Malik qala, Anas ibn Malik, he said, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the messenger said, man ala jariyataini, anyone who looks after two girls. This is, how many girls now? You see, the translation, it says daughters. It can come across as what? That's his own daughters. No. Even if you look after any other daughter, it's the same. If somebody else's daughter, it's not an issue. If you look after your siblings, you fall under it. It's just two girls. You look after them what? حَتَّى تَبْلُغَى, until they reach age of puberty. We'll speak about what are the signs for age of puberty. جَاءَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, this person will come the day of judgment. أَنَا وَهُوَ, this person and me will be what? Like this in Jannah. So the middle finger is the Prophet ﷺ, meaning he's first. And the person who looked after two girls is going to be like this. So we benefited two hadiths. The first hadith, what did it say? The person will enter Jannah. The second hadith, what did it benefit us? You're actually close to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What other status is a woman looking for? This is not for a man. So now when a man is told that his wife gave birth to a daughter, what does he get? He's happy. Alhamdulillah, this is my path to what? Not to Jannah only. To be what? Like this with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. Okay. Al-Imam al-Nawawi said, regarding this hadith, Al-Imam al-Nawawi, write this down, it's good. He said that قَامَ عَلَيْهِمَا بِالْمُؤْنَةِ, this person stands up to financially aid the girl. Her clothing, her food, the roof over her head, the father provides for her. And the parents do that. وَالتَّرْبِيَةِ وَنَحْوِهِمَا, and also the father and the mother, they look after their daughters, her deen. Some parents only understood from the tarbiyah to just physically raise their children. They believe the child has a place to sleep and food to eat. MashaAllah, I'm doing good tarbiyah. What is it that you have to do? Have to educate your children about the religion. ولذلك when it came to the ayah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَلِيكُمْ نَارًا, what did Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said, عَلِّمُوهُمْ وَأَدِّبُوهُمْ. يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, all those of you who believe, protect yourselves and your families from the hellfire. He said, what does it mean to protect your family from the hellfire? Ali ibn Abi Talib said, it means عَلِّمُوهُمْ, educate them. You see, وَأَدِّبُوهُمْ, and discipline them. So you educate them by telling them this is what the deen believes. وَأَدِّبُوهُمْ means what? To look over them. Check if your son or daughter is waking up for Fajr, because they're 10 years old now. Check if they're waking up. Don't just tell them you have to pray. Are we all together? Also, what falls under the tarbiyah of the children is setting them a good example. If you're waking up Fajr at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, or at night time you're praying all the salah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, all of them quickly, and then you say, look at my children, they're not good. Or the minute that the children come into the house, you're on the phone. Until they leave, you're on the phone as a parent. And this is not tarbiyah. The child looks at you as a role model. The Prophet tabarak wa ta'ala told us about the messenger. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. The messenger was not one to just talk to his companions and say to them, this is what Allah said, and this is what Allah said, and this is what you need to do. They used to look at him. And they used to follow what he used to do. Are we all together? وَلِذَلِكَ النَّبِيُّ اللَّهِ شَعِيبُ, what did he say to his people? He says, وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُخَالِفَكُمْ إِلَى مَا أَنْهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ, I do not want to oppose you in that which I'm telling you to do. When I tell you to do something, I don't want to do khilaf of it. Maybe like Shu'aib is saying this. But I want to be in line of what I'm telling you. أتأمرون الناس بالبر وتنسون أنفسكم وأنتم تتلون الكتاب أفلا تعقلون. Are you going to tell your children not to do this and you're doing it? Very important. Does that make sense? Very important. Children, they look at you. They really look at you and they observe everything you're doing. And wallahi, they take your statement in accordance to your actions. They do. An example for that is a young child, because his parents pray, what does he or she do? They put their abaya, the girl puts the abaya on in a hijab and she prays like her mom. Where did she get that from? She's a little baby. Who did she take this from? Huh? She took it from the parent. There was a man, it was said that he came into a city. And when he came into the city, young kids came to him and they insulted him. They name called him. And gave him different names. And he was shocked with the akhlaq of these kids. And then when he went into the city, he met a man who was very disrespectful. And then he said to him, "You're the father of those kids I saw. You're the father of those children I saw. This is where they came from." Sahih. So you have to understand, your children are looking at you. Allah is fair. He gives us chances for our children to see us as role models. We all have that opportunity. The wise one is the one who benefits from it and doesn't fall and drop in the eyes of his child. This chance that you have where your child sees everything and he tells other people, "My dad did this," or "My mom is like this," where they really look up to you. If you don't benefit from it, there will come a time whenever you say, it's like, "Okay, please." Why are they saying please? Because you just talk. All it is for you is just saying. Nothing substantial. Nothing is hardcore done. This is the truth, wallahi. A lot of parents have to understand that. الحديث الثالث, the third hadith. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري, أبي سعيد الخدري narrated عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the messenger said, إن الدنيا حلوة خضرة. This dunya is what? It's sweet and it's green. Hulwa means what? Sweet. And what does khadiratun mean? Green. What does these two characteristics show? It means that it's what's good to the person. The greenery, sightseeing. Huh? It's things people love, right? It's good for the... Are you with me, brothers? Good for what? ولذلك ابن القيم من كتاب الطب النبوي, the prophetic medicine, he mentions one of the cures is going to places where it's green, bright colors. Going to places which are bright colors is good for stress. He says that. Ibn al-Qayyim mentions that in what? طب النبوي. Where did he get it from? He got it from the ayah where صفراء لونها تسر الناظرين. That the camel, what color is it? صفراء, yellow, right? And it was تسر الناظرين, it was bringing joy to the one who was what? Meaning yellow, very bright yellow, and green gets rid of stress. Are you with me, brothers? It benefits. So going to these kind of places and sitting there, it will get rid of stress. But that's another lecture for another time. إِنَّ الدُّنْيَا حُلْوَةٌ. This world is sweet. خَضِيرَةٌ. And it is what? Green. Sweet and green. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مُسْتَخْلِفُكُمْ. And Allah is making you governors of this earth. مُسْتَخْلِف is a successor. A person comes, he dies, another person comes, and another one comes. Allah has given this world to people like that. He's placing it in their hands. Are we together? Istikhlaf means one group of people control the world and they go away. Another group comes. Allah has given this world to everyone. Why? فَيَنْظُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ. He wants to see what you guys are going to do. What are you guys going to do in this world that was given to you? How are you going to treat yourselves in this world? Are you going to follow what Allah told you to follow? Are you going to stay away from that which Allah told you to stay away from? Look what the messenger then said. He said, فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا. And what did he say? وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَى. Women. Question. Are women not part of the dunya? Why have the women been made an entity equal to the dunya? Hey, this is a good question, right? Why is dunya mentioned and then women right next to it? Isn't the women part of the dunya? Are they not part of that? Huh? We all know the famous hadith, إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كانت هجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. The dunya is mentioned and a woman. Why? We have to ask ourselves this question. Because the fitna of the dunya and the women are equal. هذا هو. The fitna that comes from women is very great. The way that a fitna from a woman, an evil woman, can put a person, a man through, it's great. ولذلك Allah تبارك وتعالى, He said, this is worth mentioning, huh? Allah عز وجل said about shaytan, He said, إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا. Shaytan's planning and his plotting is weak. But when it came to the women, Allah said, إِنَّ كَيْدَ كُنَّ عَظِيمًا. Their planning and their plotting is what? Is great. Why? Because the shaytan, you can say, أعوذ بالله, and he will go. The woman, you say, أعوذ بالله, she said, why are you saying أعوذ بالله for me? صح? Huh? This is, of course, we're not talking about a righteous, obedient woman who believes in Allah and the Day of Judgment. We're not talking about that. فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا. Have taqwa. Take precautions. Protect yourself from the dunya. وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَا. And be cautious about women. Women, any society, if you want to go to a country and feel this country, the people are good, good future awaits them, what do? Look at two people, two groups of people, their women and their youths. That's all you need to look at. Any community that you want to find whether they have a good future or not, look at their women and their youths. If their women are righteous and their youths are good, then this is a community and a society, farju lahu al-khair, hope good for them. They are upon a good way. Because shaytan, whose experience none of us can ever come to understand, Iblis has experience. Misguiding, he started it from the time of Adam. Till today he's been planning. And shaytan made his efforts through women. They would use a woman to get everything he wants. That's his way of seeing it. We'll see some of that inshallah ta'ala. We're going to see that. ولذلك shaytan today, I'm talking about shayateen al-insi and jinn, both. You're going to go to the internet and you want to get a car insurance. Okay? Whether that's permissible or not, in the UK I'm talking about. You have to. It's another discussion. Or you want to go online and you want to buy tissues. On the side there's a woman. What does the woman have to do with the tissue? Why is she always there? Why is she looking at me and always standing there? Why? What does she have to do with the bank system? Why is a woman there for? They realize that's where everything comes from. Are you with me, brothers? The enemies, that's what they understood. ولذلك الله tells us in the Quran, وَدُّوا مَا عَنِتُّمْ قَدْ بَدَتِ الْبَغْضَاءُ مِنْ أَفْوَاهِمْ. Allah tells us, وَدُّوا مَا عَنِتُّمْ. The shayateen, they hope, وَدُّوا مَا عَنِتُّمْ أَيْ عَنَتَكُمْ. They want your destruction. شياطين الإنسي and jinn, they want your destruction. That's all they're looking for, to destroy you, to destroy the community, to destroy the society, to make the men and the women lose their deen and everything. That's what they want. Are we all together? Allah is telling us subhanahu wa ta'ala that these shayateen, that's what they want. وَدُّوا مَا عَنِتُّمْ. Allah then says, قَدْ بَدَتِ الْبَغْضَاءُ مِنْ أَفْوَاهِمْ. The enmity that these shayateen have is now coming out from what? Their mouths. They're telling you the enmity. وَمَا تُخْفِي صُدُورُهُمْ أَكْبَرُ. And what they are hiding in their hearts is what? It's greater. They're hiding more things in their heart. Are we all together, brothers and sisters? Is it fair that you say today, the people who Allah is telling you, Rabbul Alameen is telling you, that they are enjoying your suffering. They want your men and your women to be like this. They want the community destroyed. They want your women to not feel success. They want depression and anxieties to grow in the community. Imagine if you say, those people are the ones who have my freedom. And they're the ones who know where my good lies. Isn't that disbelief of Allah's verse, subhanahu wa ta'ala? Isn't that questioning Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's deen? Huh? It is. Very dangerous. Al-hadith al-rabi'. The what? The fourth hadith. An Aisha ta ummi al-mu'minina, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال that the Prophet said لا يقبل الله Allah does not accept صلاة حائض إلا حائض إلا بخبار Allah does not accept the salah of a woman who has reached age of puberty لا يقبل الله Allah does not accept a woman who has reached حيض except with a khibar, she has to wear a khibar if she prays. Allah will not accept her prayer. A woman who has reached menses, except with khibar. So a woman's prayer is accepted when she reaches menstruation to wear hijab. What is it that the woman has to cover? Huh? The woman has to cover every part of her body except her two hands and her face. Every other part of her house is her body is awrah. Even if she's in her inner chamber, there's no one else in the house except her. She has to pray like that. Her face can show and her what? Her two hands. Her legs, the bottom part of her legs, the white part, cannot show. Has to be covered. Her foot, the bottom white part has to be covered. She has to either wear socks or she has to wear a long garment that covers her legs, her feet, her fingers, her toes. Sorry, they're not fingers, they're toes. Huh? Her toes. All of that, she has to cover it. She has to cover it. Her face and her hands are the only two that can show. That's when the woman reaches what? Hayd. Then we take from this, Hayd is alama min alamat al-bulugh. Number one, note this down. When a woman reaches age of puberty, how do we know? Menstruation. The woman menstruates, what do we say? She's reached bulugh, she's reached age of puberty. That's important. Walidalika, mothers specifically have to look over their daughters and find out, has she reached that time? Teach their daughters these ahkam and tell them it's nothing to worry about. As we're going to see later, this is not natural, this is normal. The way to deal with it is this. These are the ahkam that you have to follow, the rulings. Like if the sister doesn't know, فَاقِدُ شَيْءٍ لَا يُعْطِيهِ. One that doesn't have cannot give. So they themselves have to learn it, the mothers. This is why this course was very vital and it's important. And we'll speak about that in more details, inshaAllah ta'ala. Al-Imam al-Khattabi said, يُرِيدُ بِالْحَائِضِ الْمَرْأَةَ إِذَا بَلَغَتْ سِنَّ الْحَيْضِ وَلَمْ يُرِدْ بِهِ الَّتِي هِيَ فِي أَيَامِ حَيْضِهَا لِأَنَّ الْحَائِضَ لَا تُصَلِّ بِوَجْهٍ. Some people may understand from this hadith that the Prophet is saying when the woman's on her menses and she's actually on the menses that particular moment, she has to wear khimar to pray. No, that's not what the hadith means. Khattabi is explaining that to you. He's saying it's when she's reached the time when menses has started in her life. She's now become, she's reached puberty. She's hit puberty. Now she has to start wearing hijab to what? Pray the salah. That's what it means. And then, I'm going to ask you later, what's the first sign that a woman has reached age of puberty? Hayd. So far we've taken this. Alama min alamat al-bulugh. It's a sign from the signs of what? Puberty. Good. Hadith al-Khamis. Hadith number 5. وَعَنْ عَائِشَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهَا عَائِشَة said, أَيْضًا أُوصَلْ قَالَتْ دَخَلَ عَلَيَّ The messenger, صلى الله عليه وسلم, entered onto me. دَخَلَ عَلَيَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ The messenger entered onto me. وَعِنْدِي فَتَاتٌ And there was a what? So the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam entered onto my apartment where I lived. And the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he came, there was with me a young girl. Aisha had a young girl. The Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he had a garment, a lower garment. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to wear a lower and an upper garment. Are you there, brothers? So he went into his house and he brought sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what? His lower garment. He bought it. فَأَلْقَى إِلَيَّ حَقْوَهُ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he threw at me his lower garment and he said to me, شَقِّيهِ. Tear it into two. The cloth, rip it into two. Between who? بَيْنَ هَذِي الْفَتَاتِ. This girl that's with you. وَبَيْنَ الَّتِي عِنْدَ أُمُّ السَّلَمَةِ. And Umm Salama, the one that's with her. Umm Salama has a girl with her, and so do you. Divide the cloth. Give one to Umm Salama's girl, and give one to your girl. Why? فَإِنِّي لَا أَرَاهُمَا إِلَّا قَدْ حَاضَتْهَا. Because these two girls have now reached age of puberty. That's what I believe, he said. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's what I think, he said, highly, that these two girls have reached puberty. صلى الله عليه وسلم. What is the word in the hadith that was mentioned? It says حقوة. Ibn Athir, he says in his kitab نهاية في غريب الحديث, he says مادة حقا والأصل في الحقو معقد الإزار وجمعه أحقب وأحقاء ثم سمي به الإزار للمجاورة. It's the garment you wear from your waist. The garment you wear from your waist, from the middle. This hadith, what does it show us? When the girl reaches age of puberty, what does she have to do? Cover herself. Hijab is obligatory. The Prophet saying to Aisha, take this cloth, give it to this girl. She's reached age of puberty, let her cover her hair. The other one, with Umm Salama, also she's reached age of puberty, I think. Tell her to cover herself up. This shows the responsibility of the parents to observe their children. Now she has to wear hijab. Now she has to cover herself up. ولذلك أبو بكر بن أبي شيبة narrated in his مصنف عن أم سلمة رضي الله تعالى عنها that she said, إذا حاضت الجارية, if the girl reaches age, if the menstruation happens to the girl, وَجَبَ عَلَيْهَا مَا وَجَبَ عَلَىٰ أُمِّهَا مِنَ التَّسَتُّرِ. Whatever was obligatory on her mom is obligatory on her, which is to cover herself. Even if the girl reaches age of puberty at 9, she has to wear hijab. Are we all together? If she reaches age of puberty at 9, what does she have to do? Huh? She has to cover herself up. How do you know that? That's our religion. That is what? That's our religion. The menstruation is a sign of puberty. Are you all with me, brothers and sisters? Pay attention to this. So the girl has to be made to cover. She has to cover. The scholars, they differed on what age does this woman become, reach age of puberty when the other signs have not been seen in her. Are we all together? The girl hasn't reached, menstruation hasn't happened to her. She hasn't had a wet dream. Which we're going to talk about ihtilam later, inshallah ta'ala. None of that has happened to her. Scholars now differed what age. The evidence is, what does it show? 15. At the age of 15, if no other sign has seen in the boy or the girl, then we wait for 15. As soon as he reaches 15, even if the other signs don't come, he's reached age of puberty. Are we all together? But if we have the other signs before 15, you can't say, I'm waiting for 15. Or Abu Hanifa said, how many? And Imam Abu Hanifa, he said 18. And Imam Abu Hanifa, what did he say? 18. Like Imam Abu Hanifa is wrong because we have a dalil. We have evidence. Rahimahullahu ta'ala. And the evidence takes precedence of the statement of a scholar, however high he is. Are we all together? We're going to come to that hadith which mentions 15. But pay attention here, okay? This idea that you see a lot of people say, she's only 12, she's only 13, and she's got menstruation. Or this boy is 13, but he's had wet dream. Are we all together? He has ihtilam, khuruj al-mani, came out of him. You're going to wait for 15 or 18? No. The more important signs have already come. The only time we say 15 is when we don't have any of the other signs. Does that make sense? Okay. That was the first sign, which is hayd. Al-hadith al-sadis. The sixth hadith. عن علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله تعالى عنه قال he said حفظت عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم the sixth hadith علي بن أبي طالب he said I memorized from the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم what did I memorize from him لا يتم بعد احتلام there is no orphanhood you're not an orphan anymore you're not an orphan لا يتم you're not considered an orphan بعد احتلام after there has come a احتلام which is a wet dream are we all together إخراج المني that the money semen comes out of the man or the women have it as well these two signs are what احتلام is what this child is not considered an orphan why is he not considered an orphan because he's reached what puberty you can't say at this age where you've got a big beard I'm still an orphan huh I lost my parents when I was young yeah that was when you were young now لكن once you reach puberty it stops so this hadith what does it show us A second علامة من علامات البلوغ. Are we all together? A second what? Evidence of a second sign for puberty. Which is what? احتلام. احتلام. ولذلك البيهقي narrated in السنن الكبيرة أما السنن الكبرى عن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها أنها قالت عائشة said إذا احتلمت المرأة فعليها ما على أمتها من التستر. أم سلمة what did she say? Umm Salama said before, if a woman reaches menses, what does she have to do? She has to cover herself. What about if a woman receives a wet dream? What does she have to also do? She has to cover herself. What does she have to do? She also has to cover herself even if she hasn't had what? Even if she hasn't had her menses yet. Are we all together? Because ihtilam is a sign. Hayd is a sign unique for who? Unique for the girl. And ihtilam is a sign unique for the what? Shared by who? Sorry. By the man and the woman. This is a sign for both of them. And the third sign is what? The third sign is what? 15. The Sheikh is bringing all of the signs for you in order. He's now going to bring the third sign, which is what did I say? The number. 15. So the first is hayd. If that's not present for the girl, ihtilam. If that couldn't be found, what do we go for? 15 now. We wait when she reaches 15. And now she's considered a, she's reached age of puberty. عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عرضه يوم أحد وهو ابن 14 سنة. عبد الله بن عمر, he presented himself to the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام when he was what? When he was 14, he said to the Prophet of Allah, I'm 14, I want to participate in the battle of Uhud. فَلَمْ يُجِزْنِي The messenger said, I'm not going to allow you. No, go back, you're too young. Because Abdullah ibn Umar didn't have what? He did not reach age of puberty. He didn't have ihtilam. And he hadn't reached what? 15, he's 14. So the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what? I'd go back. ثم عرضني يوم الخندق One year later was the battle of what? The trench. He came وأنا ابن عشرة أو أنا ابن خمسة عشرة سنة. I was 15 this time. فأجازني he said you can participate now. Why? Because he's reached what? He's reached age of puberty. قال نافع نافع said نافع is the مولى ابن عمر he is a slave boy of عمر عبد الله بن عمر he said فقدمت على نافع said فقدمت على عمر بن عبد العزيز I came to عمر بن عبد العزيز وهو خليفة عمر بن عبد العزيز was the governor at this time فحدثت هذا الحديث I told him about this hadith of عبد الله بن عمر that the prophet didn't allow him at the age of 14 but he allowed him in what age 15 I told him this فقال he said إن هذا لحد بين الصغير والكبير. عمر بن عبد العزيز then said, Ah, this is the distinguishing factor between the one who's young and the one who's reached age of puberty. وكتب إلى عماله. He wrote to his what? His workers that were representing him, the governors, he wrote to all of them, and يَفْرِضُ لِمَنْ بَلَغَ خَمْسَ عَشَرَةً. Anyone who reaches 15, it's obligatory on them. The jurisprudent rulings apply on them. The ahkam التَّكْلِيفِيَّة apply on them. Now they reach age of puberty. But before that, no. The child is. So now, what did we take? We've taken three signs. One unique to women, one shared, the second shared by men and women, and the third is what? Shared by both parties. Al-Hadith al-Thamini, the eighth hadith. An Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Aisha. Qalat, she said, Qala Rasulullah, the messenger said, Fil Haydi, regarding the woman who's on her menses, Inna hadha this, Amrun katabahu Allahu ala banati Adam. Menstruation is what? It's something Allah wrote on the children of what? On the women of the women from the children of Adam. So what did the Christians believe? It was a what? They believe it's a punishment from God towards the women. We don't believe that. What do we believe? إن هذا أمر كتبه الله على بنات آدم. This is something Allah wrote for the and has ordained for the daughters of Adam. Pay attention here. That's what the parent needs to teach his daughter, or the mother needs to teach her daughter, that the daughter shouldn't worry, shouldn't be scared. This is أمر جبلي. This is a normal thing. Allah created this in women. Allah created them in it. And this is something that the person, the girl is taught, that no khawf or wajal has to come from her. This is what needs to be taught. And this type of hadith is there to say that. Are we all together? Al-hadith al-tasi', the ninth hadith. عن علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله the messenger said رفع القلم the pen has been lifted عن ثلاثة three types of people the pen has been lifted meaning it's not written on nothing is written against them okay the pen is lifted from three types of people عن الصبي حتى يبلغ a boy until he reaches puberty A girl, until she reaches puberty, pen is lifted from them. Huh? The girl and the boy, when they're young, they do what? They do wrong things, but nothing. No one's holding them account. Like if some people misunderstood this concept, which is, what does it mean that it's not written for them? What about if a child jumps into the parent's car and drives it, and then he damages things? What has to be done? Do we say that رفع القلم عن ثلاث that the pen has been lifted from three? Yeah? This means the judgment of the day of judgment. Nothing's been held account for him on the day of judgment. لكن whatever he causes problem to in this world, he has to pay it back. That's not, he's not exempt from that. Just the same way, if a crazy person jumps into the steering wheel and drives and runs a person over, it's not considered to be deliberate killing, but there's blood money. We can't just say to this person who lost his family member, oh, رفع القلم عن ثلاثة. That the pen is lifted from what? Three. إذا مؤاخذة دنيوي, the accountability of this world is present. لكن the day of judgment, no. لكن the second, the crazy one, If he did to himself what made him crazy, he took drugs, and then he became crazy. He is held accountable for what he does. All the salah he misses, all the disobedience that he comes with, he's held accountable for that. Are you with me, brothers? The second, رفع القلم عن ثلاثة عن الصبي حتى يبلغ the young boy until he reaches age of puberty حتى يبلغ وعن النائم حتى يستيقظ. And the one who's sleeping until he what? Wakes up. If a person is a heavy sleeper and he doesn't wake up, then Allah won't hold him account until he wakes up. وَعَنِ الْمَجْنُونِ حَتَّى يَبْرَأَ And the one who's insane until he gains his sanity, nothing is held account The awamir and the nawahi are lifted from him. Like, as we mentioned, the awamir and the nawahi of Allah is lifted from him. Like, in the consequences of his action, he has to be paid. Al-Hadith al-Ashir, the 10th hadith. An Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. Annaha qalat, she said, سألت امرأة رسول الله, a woman asked the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, she said, أرأيت, O messenger of Allah, do you see إحدانا إذا أصاب ثوبها الدم, a woman, her menses happens to her and then the menses goes on her clothing, the blood goes on her clothing, من الحيضة, from the menses, menstruation, كيف تصنع, what would she do in this situation? And these women didn't have a lot of clothing. So what did she do? فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, the messenger said, إِذَا أَصَابَ ثَوْبَ إِحْدَاكُنَّ, if the menses, the menstruation, goes on one of your clothes, meaning for the women, مِنَ الْحَيْذَةِ فَلْتَقْرُصْهُ, what the woman should do is rub it. Let's try to scratch it off once it becomes dry on there. ثُمَّ لِتَنْضَحُ بِمَاءٍ, and then she sprinkle water onto it. ثُمَّ لِتُصَلِّ فِيهِ, and then let her pray on it. She didn't have to wash the whole clothes. Whatever place it went onto, she has to just wash that place. Okay? And she has to sprinkle water on it. And then she can pray on it. Even if there's still a stain that can be seen, لا بأس به, there's no problem. As long as she what? She washed it with water and she took what was on it. If there's still a stain, لا بأس به, there's no issue with. The women have to understand quickly, the blood that comes from the women are three types. The first one is حيض, menstruation. What is it? Menstruation. Okay? That's the most common one that's known. The second one is called النفاس. And nifas is what? Postnatal bleeding is the one that comes after بعد الولادة, when she gives birth. 40 days, the Sharia gave her. The third one is called istihada. Istihada is what? Huh? It's called continued bleeding. It just goes on. It doesn't stop. The Prophet ﷺ told us that the istihada, the postnatal bleeding, is shaitan kicked the vein of the woman, and that's what's causing the bleeding to go on. He doesn't want her to pray, and he wants to cause her confusion. The messenger told us this, and we believe it, alayhi salatu wasalam. Who told us this? The Prophet told us it's a rakzun. It's a kicking from who? Shaytan. Each one, the hukum regarding it, we'll take it after the salah, inshallah ta'ala. So, we were talking about the blood that comes from the woman. We said that the blood that comes from the woman is how many types? Three types. The first one is called al-haydu. Hayd is the well-known blood that comes from the woman once a month. What is the minimum of hayd? What's the bare minimum? And what is the maximum? The scholars, لا حد في الشرع لقلة لأقله وأكثره. The minimum and the majority that hayd is, the Sharia didn't mention this. So a woman cannot say the bare minimum of my hayd is this much. And she can't say the maximum is this much. This all goes back to what? Huh? وَالْعُرْفُ مَعْمُولٌ بِهِ إِذَا وَرَدْ حُكْمٌ مِنَ الشَّرْعِ الشَّرِيفِ لَمْ يُحَدْ. If the Sharia does not give a restriction to something, what do we go back to? We go to the custom and the culture and the norms of the people. The second blood, what do we say is called? An-nifas. Nifas is the what? Postnatal bleeding. It's the blood that comes from the woman after huwa damul kharij bisabab al-wilada. It is the blood that comes out after giving birth. This, how much is the maximum? The postnatal bleeding is 40 days. Okay? This is based on the hadith of Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha. She said, كانت النفساء تجلس على عهد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 40 يوما. The women who were on her, that were on their postnatal bleeding at the time of the messenger, they would stay and hold back for 40 days. For 40 days, they don't pray. If the woman becomes pure before the 40 days, she prays her salah. If she becomes pure, the 40 days is the maximum. Okay, it doesn't mean that she's pure and she still sits around for 40 days. It means that the 40 days is the maximum. And if she reaches 40 and she's still not pure, she prays her salah. Are we all together? If she reaches 40 and she doesn't, the blood did not stop, she what? She carries on praying her salah and she just purifies herself. Does that make sense? That's the postnatal bleeding. The third blood is called istihadha. What is it called? It's called istihadha. Istihadha means blood that comes out في غير أوقات الحيض والنفاس. It comes out other than the time of حيض and other than the time of نفاس. نفاس is what? The postnatal bleeding. So it's not menstruation, nor is it postnatal bleeding. It's a blood that just goes on. Women in this situation are two types. The women are how many types when it comes to the istihadha, the continuous bleeding? There are two types. One is a woman which is known as the mu'tada. Mu'tada is a woman who can distinguish one from the other. How could she distinguish it from one another? How could she distinguish? She can distinguish it from two ways. This woman, she knows it in two ways. The first way is her istihadha started in later stages of her life. And her menstruation that used to come was well organized, meaning it was scheduled, and it never used to miss its schedule. So she knows her time when her haid comes has never changed. It's always been the first of every month, for example. Are we all together? She knows it. If istihadha starts later, she knows the days which she used to have her menses, she follows that. She's called what? Mu'tada. She's called a mu'tada. She knows her. She has aada. She has a routine. She knows it. The second way she can know it is, she knows when she sees it. Damul hayd, as the Prophet ﷺ told us, is black. Well, istihadha is a vein. It's normal bleeding. It's red blood. The density of the hayd is heavier than the density of the istihadha. The smell that of the hayd is different from that of istihadha. There's a bad smell to the hayd, whereas the istihadha doesn't have that. Am I making sense? That's the woman who's called the mu'tada. Mu'tada means what? She knows. Am I making sense? Yeah. The second one is mutahayyira. She's confused. What's she called? Mutahayyira. She's confused. She doesn't know one from the other. Why does she not know? She doesn't know because maybe when hayd started in her life, so did istihadha start with it. So she doesn't know which one is which. She's confused. Or it started later, but her hayd was never scheduled. Aslan, it used to just go all over the place. It never had no routine. Are we all together? وَلِذَٰلِكَ one of the hardest chapters in fiqh is hayd. And women don't make it easy. Why? Because they don't memorize their timings. It's very important. It helps the shaykh when he gives fatwa to help him to be a mu'tada. To just have a schedule of your routine. And know when it starts and when it ends. When it starts, when it ends. She'll come to you and she says to you, I don't know, nothing. I have no knowledge of it. وَلِذَٰلِكَ is hardest chapter in fiqh. Why? Because there's no book you go to and you look into. She's mutahayyira, she's confused. Are we all together? She comes with a unique situation. The answer has to be in line of her situation. So what's she called? She's called mutahayyira, she's confused. This mutahayyira, okay, and who's confused, she doesn't know. What will be done is, will be said, from the blood that's coming from you, pick days from it, and that's going to be the days of your hayd, khalas. And based on the women who are close to you, your sisters, because I don't know if you guys know, but women's menstruation happens if they're together all the time. That's how it is. Yeah, it happens if they're together. And it starts together, it finishes. So this, her sisters and all she's around, she takes their menstruation. What does she take? She takes their menstruation. When it starts, when it finishes. That's called the mutahayyara. Are we all together? This is fast rulings. What is the woman who's on her istihada? What is not allowed for her? If she's on continuous bleeding, is there anything that's prohibited from her? No. Istihada, she prays, she fasts, she can touch the mushaf, she can read the Quran, she can have an intimate relationship with her husband. Istihada is normal, nothing changes. Are we all together? The woman who is what? Istihada. Like in the woman who's upon hayd and what? And on nifas, there are three things that are ijma', unanimous agreement she can't do. The woman who's on hayd and she's on what? Nifas. Three things are ijma' she's not allowed to do. Number one, she's not allowed to fast. She's not allowed to fast. Ijma', there's no dispute in this issue. We're going to touch on that later more, inshallah ta'ala. The hadith of Mu'adha when she asked Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Number two is al-wat'u fil farji, intimate relationship. A man cannot have sexual intercourse with his wife while she's upon hayd or while she's in state of nifas. ولذلك الإمام النووي رحمه الله after he brought the hadith اسمعوا كل شيء إلا النكاح, do everything to the woman who's on her menstruation or nifas other than nikah. Nikah here means what? الوطء. Because nikah can come, it comes in two meanings, الوطء والعقد. وطء means intimacy and العقد means contract. So a man can do anything with his wife other than have sexual relationship, sexual intercourse. Look what الإمام النووي said. الإمام النووي said in شرح صحيح مسلم under this hadith, he said ولو اعتقد مسلم, if a Muslim believes حل جماع الحائض, that he's allowed to have intimate relationship with a woman while she's on her menstruation, he believes it's halal, you can. في فرجها صار كافرا مرتدا, he becomes a disbeliever. If a man believes it's halal, there's nothing wrong with it, for him to have intimacy with a woman while she's on her menstruation, Nawawi says كافر مرتد, he becomes. Because this مسألة, there's كتاب in the Sunnah. يسألونك عن المحيض يقول هو أذى فاعتزلوا النساء في المحيض. Allah says get far from the woman when she's on المحيض. And there's a consent. No two scholars disputed. If 1,400 something years later someone comes and says, you know what? She's my wife. I can do what I want. It doesn't make sense to me. If we want it, it's a consent between the two of us. This, he said, it's what? كافرا مرتدا. ولو فعله إنسان غير معتقد حله. What about if somebody does it, but he doesn't believe it's halal? He does it. فإن كان ناسيا, if he forgot, أو جاهلا, or he's ignorant, بوجود الحيض, he didn't know she was on menses, or she didn't even know. Okay, they didn't know. Or they were both ignorant, and they didn't even know the ruling. أو جاهلا بتحريمه, أو مكرها, or if he was forced to do it, فلا إثم عليه, then there's no harm in him. ولا كفارة, and there's no expiation. وإن وطئها عامدا, but what about if he does her deliberately? عَالِمًا بِالْحَيْضِ, he doesn't believe it's halal. He knows it's wrong what he's doing. He believes it's haram in the sharia. But he does it deliberately. And he knows that she's on her menses. And he does it. He said here, فَقَدْ ارْتَكَبَ مَعْصِيَةً كَبِيرًا, it's a major sin. نَصَّ الشَّافِعِيُّ, الإمام الشَّافِعِيُّ said that it's a major sin. وَتَجِبُ عَلَيْهِ التَّوْبَةِ, he has to repent. وفي وجوب الكفارة قولان, and there's two views whether that person should give a what? Kafara, expiation. And the qawl which is rajih is that if a man has intimate relationship with his wife deliberately while she's on her menstruation or whilst she's on her postnatal bleeding, it's the strongest opinion is after repentance there's an expiation he has to pay. Where is that? It's the statement of Abdullah ibn Abbas mawqufan. وابن عباس, he said about the woman who's on her menstruation, what did he say? يتصدق بدينار أو نصف دينار. The Prophet said this. She pays what? The person pays one dinar or we have يتصدق بدينار, one dinar or half a dinar. صح? How much is a dinar? 4 grams of gold. Are we all together? The man has to pay 4 grams of what? the wife and the husband, be careful. Okay? Here, the hadith mentioned, bidinarin or nisfi dinar. The Prophet said, dinar or. So here there's a takhir. Can you choose whichever you want? Yeah? Abdullah ibn Abbas said, no, you don't choose whichever you want. The difference, he said, in asabaha fi fawri dami tasaddaqa bi dinarin. If he does it the early stages when she's on her menstruations, he has to pay 1 dinar. If he does it the last days of her menstruation, he pays 0.5 dinar. Wa in kana fi akhirihi fa nisfu dinarin. Does that make sense? So these are the ahkam pertaining to hayd. Quickly, okay? Lakin, whether the woman can touch the mushaf while she's on her menstruation, or she can go to the masjid while she's on her menstruation, we'll talk about that soon, inshallah. That's not an agreed upon issue. It's a different upon issue, whether a woman can touch the mushaf when she's on her menstruation. We'll talk about that soon. The Shaykh is going to bring the hadith, inshallah ta'ala. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه حديث 11 أن خولة بنت يسار أتت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت خولة, she came to the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم and she said to him, يا رسول الله أو messenger of Allah, إنه ليس لي إلا ثوب, I don't have except a garment, واحد, I only have one garment, وأنا أحيض and menstruation happens to me, فكيف أصنع, what shall I do? قال, the messenger said to her, إذا طهرتي فاغسليه, if you become pure, if you what? You become pure, if you become pure, he said, when you become pure, wash your clothing. Get the clothing and what? Wash it. ثم صلي فيه, the prayer side. فقالت, he said, فإن لم يخرج الدم, if the blood doesn't go after you cleaned it, يكفيك الماء, the water will suffice you, ولا يضرك أثره, the mark that's there does not harm you. We're already told, you scratch it off and you wash it with water, if there's still a mark, don't worry. But now, alhamdulillah, the women, they have what? They got other clothing, so they can just get rid of that one and wear another clothing. But if they don't, this is what they do. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله تعالى عنه قال, he said, خرج رسول الله, the messenger came out, في أضحى, the messenger spoke to the men, and then he went and he spoke to who? The women. So the Prophet ﷺ addressed the men, and then he privately went to the women. And that shows you how Islam gives importance to the education of the women. But mainly when we mean education here, chemistry and biology. Yeah. No, we first of all, we mean the religion. And then anything after that, no problem. A woman to learn knowledge of the dunya, no problem. She can if she wants to. Like, we mean number one, first thing that she learns what? The religion. So the messenger came out. He came to the women's musalla. فَمَرَّ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ, the Prophet went by the women. فَقَالَ, he said to them, يَا مَعْشَرَ النِّسَاءِ, O women, تَصَدَّقْنَا, give charity. فَإِنِّي أُرِيتُكُنَّ, I was shown. فَإِنِّي أُرِيتُكُنَّ, I was shown that you women are أَكْثَرُ أَهْلِ النَّارِ, the majority in hellfire. Who are the majority of the inhabitants of the hellfire? Men or women? The women. Huh? The majority is who? It's the women. Who said this? الَّذِي لَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى, the one who doesn't talk from his own whims and desires. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Everything he says is what? Saying, this doesn't make sense to me, is questioning Nabiullah Muhammad. Very dangerous. Because at the beginning, what do we take the muqaddimah? The Prophet is talking about a waqi' that he saw. A reality. He saw alayhi salatu wasalam the night he was ascending up. Laylat Isra al-Mi'raj, he saw all of this. He saw that the majority of the inhabitants of the hellfire were women. فَقُلْنَا, look at the sahabiyat now, and the difference between some of the women of this time. When this was said, look at their response. They didn't say, no, we have to uprise, protest, billboards, right? Huh? They didn't say that. فَقُلْنَا We said, وَبِمَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ Why? We know we are, because you told us, but why? They want to avoid it. They said, وَبِمَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ Why are we? So this is what the woman should focus more on. And don't challenge the reality that's already there. Avoid your flesh and your bone from being from the inhabitants of the hellfire. She said, وَبِمَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ Why, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet then told us, عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, تُكْثِرْنَا اللَّعْنَةِ You curse a lot. The women, in terms of their tongue, what comes out of it, they are less observing. They speak, and they think later the consequences of what they just said. تُكْثِرْنَا اللَّعْنَةِ You increase in the cursing. You're cursing your own child. Your own child, and then you want Allah to guide him. You're saying to him, لَعْنَةُ عَلَيْكِ To your own child. And then what do you want? You want him to be Imam al-Bukhari. Bukhari's mother didn't curse him. You see, this is the reality, wallahi. The same with fathers who are cursing their own what? Their own children, their own. Nabi Muhammad ﷺ, one day look what he saw. One day he saw a man who had a riding beast. And what did the man do? He cursed the riding beast. And then the man wanted to keep the riding beast with him. The messenger said, get rid of this riding beast. We do not want to be with us an animal that the curse of Allah is coming down. فَأَطْلِقُوهُ Let it go. So you're saying, oh Allah, curse of Allah be upon this child, or curse of Allah be upon this man I'm with. And then tomorrow you're hugging him and you're with him. And the curse is coming down on him because you asked for it, did you not? And then you're with the cursed one. Are we all together? So the first one is, تُكْثِرْنَا اللَّعْنَةِ You increase on cursing. وَتَكْفُرْنَا الْعَشِيرَةِ وَتَكْفُرْنَا الْعَشِيرَةِ You are ungrateful to your spouses. تَكْفُرْنَا here means you have kufran. Kufran is lack of gratitude. You don't show gratitude. Yes, the man is doing so much work. He's there for you. Yesterday you were saying, I've never seen anyone like you. Yeah, you've helped me. You've aided me. You supported me. My life has changed when I met you. Tomorrow you say, on the way, can you pick up milk for us? And he goes, I can't. And she says, A'udhu Billah, you destroyed my life. You, may Allah, yeah, may Allah deal with you. And if you just scrolls up, the message was nice before that. So what is it? وَتَكْفُرْنَا الْعَشِيرَةِ You're ungrateful to your spouse. وَلِذَلِكَ I have to point on this point, and it's very vital, wallahi. مِنْ بَابِ الْأَمَانِ I have to be truthful. And Imam Ibn Kathir mentions in his kitab, دَلَائِلُ النُّبُوَّةِ Which is a book that indicates the Prophet's prophecy. This hadith, Ibn Kathir graded it to be hasan. The Prophet ﷺ, a group of men came to him and they said, Ya Rasulullah, we have a camel. We have a camel. And this camel has now become like a wolf. It's eating people. Vicious, the camel. So the Messenger ﷺ said, bring the camel to me. So they brought the camel and the camel was in the corner of the masjid. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he saw the camel, he walked towards it. The Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, don't go. The camel will eat you. Because it was biting and it was ripping. So the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam ignored it. And he walked towards the camel. And as he walked closer to the camel prostrated. For who? The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then when the companions saw this, they were shocked. They said, Ya Rasulullah, this is a camel. It understood your status. Wallahi, we know you better. We should prostrate to you, O Messenger of Allah. And then the Messenger said, if I was to command a people to prostrate for a people, لَأَمَرْتُ الْمَرْأَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِزَوْجِهَا لِعِظَمِ الْحَقِّ عَلَيْهَا I would have commanded for the woman to prostrate to her husband because of the great rights that he has on her. If I was to command anyone to prostrate for anyone, I would have said, look at the mawqif, look at the position he's saying it at. I would have told the woman to prostrate. Prostration is what, brothers? It's the highest level in ubudiyyah, the highest level of servitude. It's the time the Prophet said, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ لِرَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدٍ The time you're the most closest to Allah is when? In the salah. When? In the sujood. The Prophet said, I would have, if I was, I would have told the woman to prostrate for her husband. لِعِظَمِ الْحَقِّ عَلَيْهَا The hadith goes on. Look what he said. The Prophet said this. Nabiullah Muhammad said this. He said that if the man had pus come out of his body, pus, and the woman, she licked it off, ما أدت حقه, she would not fulfill his rights. That same hadith, he said it. Who is saying that? The messenger. A mu'mina, tu'minu billahi wa bil yawm al-akhir. When she looks at that hadith, she makes sure that she fulfills the rights that is upon her. She doesn't come the day of judgment and she's accounted for. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةِ. If Allah and His Messenger judge something, you have no choice. A woman came to the Messenger, she said, Ya Rasulullah, a woman, she came to the Messenger, she said, Ya Rasulullah, I got married. And then he said to her, هُوَ جَنَّتُكِ وَنَارُكِ. Your Jannah and Nar is in his hands. By pleasing him is Jannah, and angering him is what? It's the hellfire. Majority of you men and women probably don't hear this hadith. It's hidden, it's not mentioned. Are we all together, brothers? Like, what men need to understand is the man who deserves that is a man who's fulfilled his part as well. A man who's come with what is upon him. Allah tells us in the Quran, الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض وبما أنفقوا من أموالهم. A man is قوام, meaning he stands for the affairs of his family and he stands for what is needed from him. Is the one that's found from him what? Number one, he financially supports his family. A man whose wife, he doesn't financially aid her, he doesn't give her anything, he has not fulfilled her rights. And the day of judgment, he's going to come destroyed. The second one is, وَبِمَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. The physical help. A man needs to physically help the wife. This is a right she has on you. And not to watch her take on everything physically. Are we all together, brothers? He has to help her with her mind, with planning and structuring things out. It falls under, وَبِمَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بَعْضَكُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. And not say, you organize everything, I'll just make sure it happens. Are we all together? When both parties, brothers and sisters, pay attention, the wife and the husband, both see it as, these ahadiths are here to save our marriage. It's here for it to make it better. And not, the wife says to the husband, you read the rights that's upon you. And the husband goes, well, you read the rights that's upon you. And no one really reads any rights that's upon them. Are we all together? This becomes a problem now. The man needs to enjoy reading the rights that's upon him. And he needs to, every time, check if he's following it. And so is the what? The woman. Inshallah ta'ala, Allah will then look at that relationship and give it the best it deserves. Care for it. Admire, make place in their hearts, love towards one another. تُكْثِرْنَا اللَّعْنَةَ. You increase in cursing. وَتَكْفُرْنَا الْعَشِيرَةَ. And you are what? Ungrateful to your husbands. Then look what the Prophet said. مَا رَأَيْتُ. I did not see. مِنْ نَاقِصَاتِ عَقْلٍ. Those who have less, the Prophet said, I haven't seen naqisatu aqlin. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I have not seen anyone more deficient in intellect and religion than you, O women. The women are deficient in two things, the Prophet said. What is it? Yeah? Intellect and what? Religion. Please understand the context that the Prophet said it in. It will make you understand a very good point. Okay? Was it the Prophet putting the woman down? Alayhi salatu, look what he said after that. He said, that woman who is deficient in her intelligence or intellect, what can she do? He said, أَذْهَبَ لِلُّبِّ الرَّجُلِ الْحَازِمِ مِنْ إِحْدَاكُنَّ. A man who is smart and he's diligent, she's able to fool him, trick him. I'm amazed the Prophet said. Though a woman who's meant to be intellectually deficient, she is able to get into the mind of an intelligent, diligent man. He's looking around, he's making sure everything is vigilant, careful. She's able to take it. Are we all together? This shows us something, which is a woman who is smart knows the keys to her husband's heart. She knows what to do. And one of the things that a woman needs to remember is her biggest powerful weapon is her femininity. What do I mean by that? by being harsh with your husband and having a toe-to-toe, it won't get you nowhere, sisters. Because the man deals with that every day on the streets, at work. People are toe-to-toe with him every day. And Allah created him with that strength. The weakest thing for a man is when his wife is soft. Her nature, and what she is, can convince him to do whatever she wants. She can get whatever she wants from him. The Prophet stated this to us. The man can be the most smartest of men. He can be the what? Most diligent and most vigilant man on the face of this earth. Wallahi, you'd see him, and a woman's got control of his affairs. He says, I'll have to go home at 9 o'clock. I have to. MashaAllah, that's good. There's nothing wrong with that. Okay. Then the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam explains the two, the deen and the aqal. Why is it deficient? Look at the sahabiyat, wallahi. They never, look at their iman. They never said, Ya Rasulullah, that's not fair. That doesn't make sense. What are you talking about? No, they didn't say that. Wallahi, they didn't say that. Radiallahu ta'ala anhum. Then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they said, just tell us how we are. They have accepted that they are. But they just said, how? وَمَا نُقْصَانُ دِينِنَا How is our religion deficient? وَعَقْلِنَا our intelligence. Then the Messenger said, أَلَيْسَ شَهَادَةُ الْمَرْأَةِ مِثْلَ نِصْفِ شَهَادَةِ الرَّجُلِ The woman's witness is how many? Two women is equal to what? This is حُكُم شَرْعِي No one is allowed to change that. Allah made this. لِعِلْمٍ يَعْلَمُهَا اللَّهُ Allah knows why. We are slaves. The way we were not consulted in our creation, this ruling Allah doesn't have to consult us. He doesn't have to explain He doesn't have to explain it to us. We just have to say what? Sabi'na wa ata'na. We hear, O Allah, because we're slaves. That's what a slave is. We hear and we obey, O Allah. We take what you say. Qulna bala. Look at the women. What was their response? What did they say? When he said, two women is equal to one man, what did the sahabiyat say? Did they say na'am or bala? Huh? Did they say na'am or bala? Do you know the difference between na'am and bala? Na'am just means yes, bala means of course. The sahabiyat, they said, of course! Two women is equal to, of course, Ya Rasulullah. That's what they said. That's the iman that gushed out of their hearts, wallahi. That they didn't question. Radiallahu ta'ala anhum. فَذَٰلِكَ مِنْ نُقْصَانِ عَقْلِهَا The reason two women is equal to one is because of this aql. أَلَيْسَ إِذَا حَاضَتْ لَمْ تُصَلِّ وَلَمْ تَصُمْ What about if the woman is on her menstruation? And what about when she's on her nifas? What does she? Does she pray and does she fast? No, she doesn't. The sahabiyat, they said, بَلَا, of course, O Messenger of Allah, she doesn't. He said, فَذَٰكَ مِنْ نُقْصَانِ This is the deficiency in her what? In her deen, her religion. Al-hadith al-thalith ashara. Hadith 13. Embrace these ahadiths. If you see that you have, you're repulsive towards these ahadith, ask Allah to cure your heart. It's an illness of the heart. Wallahi, that's what it is. What is it? It's an illness in the heart. Wallahi, this hadith is going to stay. And you who believe this hadith doesn't make sense, you're going to perish. The hadith is going to be in Bukhari, إِلَىٰ أَنْ يَرِثَ اللَّهُ الْأَرْضَ وَمَنْ عَلَيْهَا This hadith is going to be Sahih Muslim and it's going to remain forever. All the feminists can come and they can go. Bukhari will not go. Muslim, this hadith will stay. And this understanding will remain until the Day of Judgment. So the person should just be merciful towards the hereafter. Don't do anyone a favor other than your what? Other than yourself. From the hellfire by going against the command of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Mu'adha rahimahullah qalat. Mu'adha, she said. Mu'adha, she said. Sa'altu, I asked Aisha. Radiallahu ta'ala anha, I asked her. Faqultu, I said to her. Ma balu al-ha'idhi taqdi sawma wa la taqdi salata. Why is it that if a woman's on her menstruation, she has to bring back the fasting, but she doesn't have to bring back the prayer? The prayer is important in the salah of fasting. She doesn't bring the important thing back, but she brings the fasting back. It doesn't make sense. Does that make sense? This woman, she asked Aisha, her name was Mu'adha. She said to Aisha radiallahu anha, مَا بَالُ الْحَائِضُ تَقْضِ الصَّوْمَ وَلَا تَقْضِ الصَّلَاةَ She has to, when a woman's Ramadan comes, okay, and a woman misses 7 days in Ramadan, does she have to bring back the 7 days of the prayer that she missed? No. She doesn't have to bring back the prayer. But does she have to bring back the fasting? What's more important, the fasting or the prayer? The prayer is more important. But she has to bring back the fasting, but not the prayer. I want you to benefit from this hadith. Aisha, first thing she said, before she even answered her question, she said to her, أَحَرُورِيَّةٌ أَنْتِ أَيُّ حَرُورِي. Haruri was a Khawarij group who went out in a place called Harura. This shows that if a person comes with the statement of Ahlul Bidah, you can say to that person, are you from the Ahlul Bidah? The group in which their ideology they are in line with, you can ask them, are they of that group? You can ask them. And the person should say, oh, you're accusing me. Are we all together? Aisha asked, she said to her, are you Haruri? Why? Because the Khawarij, the Haruriya, believed that the woman had to bring them back to prayer. The Khawarij used to say, she has to bring back the prayer because it doesn't make sense to us, they said. That the Salah, which is more important, is told not to bring back, brought back. And the what? And the fasting is. Aisha, first thing she said to the woman is, أَحَرُورِيَّةٌ أَنْتِي. Are you a Haruri? The woman didn't say, it's so unfair you're calling me Haruri, وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. She didn't say that. She answered the question. If you're not the group, then you should be happy to say I'm not, right? Why are you so offensive? Why are you hiding the answer? I have to just quickly say, I'm not. She said to her, لست بحروريتي. I am not a Haruri. ولكني أسألو. I'm only asking you. I just want to know. I'm not a Haruri. قالت عائشة then said to her, كان يصيبنا ذلك. This used to happen to us. Menstruation used to happen to us at the time of the Prophet. فَنُؤْمَرُ بِقَضَاءِ الصَّوْمِ. We were told to bring back the fasting. وَلَا نُؤْمَرُ بِقَضَاءِ الصَّلَاةِ. And we were not told to bring back the salah. What did Aisha use as evidence? We are slaves, we're commanded what to do and what not to do. Simple. She didn't go, logically, it makes sense, look at it, the fasting are too many, how is she going to bring back 5 days? She didn't say any of that. She said, we were commanded to do this and we were told not to do this. خلاص. The woman, on the other hand, knowing how important it is, the Kitab and the Sunnah, what did she say? Okay. That's how simple our deen is. Are we all together, brothers? We're complicating it when we try to go too much philosophical answers. Just say, Rasulullah commanded this. When Aisha says, فَنُؤْمَرُ, the Sahabas, when they say, we are commanded, who do they mean? The Messenger. When the Messenger says, أُمِرْتُ, I was commanded, who does he mean? Allah. Are we all together? That's important to understand. Al-Hadith al-Rabi Ashara, the 14th Hadith, عن أنس, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, أنس, he said, قال, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, إِسْنَعُوا, do كُلَّ شَيْءٍ, everything إِلَّا النِّكَاحَ. Do with your spouse when she's on her hayd, menstruation. Do with her what? Everything except what? Except nikah. Nikah here means what? Al-wat fi al-farji, sexual intercourse. Meaning the man can do every other thing with his wife. He can hug, he can kiss, no problem. The Jews, what did they used to do? They used to take the woman when she was on her menstruation, and there was a tent they built for her. She would stay in that tent till the days that she's on her menstruation. Things were thrown at her. Her clothes, whatever she needed, soap, whatever she needed was thrown at her. The food was given to her on a long stick. Akada. She ate. Some of them would not shower or clean themselves for those days. And so when she comes to the day of her purification, they will send for her a ram, and the animal will die because of the smell. That's how they used to deal with them. So Islam came and it liberated all of that. What did it do? It said, we're not going to go to the extreme of what? The Jews and the extreme of the Christians. The Christians, what did they do? They had intimacy with their women while she was on her menstruation. And كِلَ الطَّرَفَيْنِ مَذْمُومٌ. Both parties are blameworthy. Both extreme. What did the Messenger ﷺ used to do with Aisha? She said he would place a cloth between my navel and my knee, and then he would foreplay with me, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This, but he would not do any intimate sexual intercourse with her. So he said, إِصْنَعُوا, do everything. كُلَّ شَيْءٍ, everything, illa nikaha, don't have sexual intercourse with her. And that's, this hadith proves that, and the ayah, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيضِ قُلْ هُوَ أَذَنْ فَاعْتَزِلُ النِّسَاءَ فِي الْمَحِيضِ. And that's a mas'ala which is ijma', there's no dispute. And I brought the statement of who? الإمام النووي رحمه الله تعالى. الحديث الخامس عشرة. حديث what? حديث 15, which is what? عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها, she said, قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the messenger said, افعلي دو ما يفعل الحاج غير ألا تطوفي بالبيت. The next, what was the thing that the woman is not allowed to do? She's not allowed to go. She's not allowed to pray. She's not allowed to fast. She's not allowed to do what? Sexual intercourse. And the husband is not allowed to do sexual intercourse with her while she's on her menstruation. And nor is the woman. Four, the woman who's on her menstruation or her on her postnatal bleeding, she's not allowed to do what? Tawaf around the Kaaba. She's not allowed to. If علي ما يفعل الحاج, do what the Hajj is doing. غير ألا تطوفي بالبيت حتى تطهري. A woman is not allowed to, she's not allowed to go around the Kaaba how many times? 7 times while she's on her menstruation. This is not permissible for her. الحديث السادس عشرة, the 16th hadith. What is this hadith? Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr ibn Abi Hazm, he said, أن في الكتاب الذي كتبه رسول الله لعمر بن حزم, the messenger sent a letter to who? To Amr ibn Hazm. The messenger sent a letter to who? Who did he send the letter to? Yeah? To Amr ibn. And what did he say? He said, alayhi salatu wasalam, أَلَّا يَمَسَّ الْقُرْآنَ إِلَّا طَاهِرٌ. No one should touch the Qur'an except that they are pure. And that they are in state of tahara. So, is a woman allowed to touch the mushaf while she's on her menstruation? Or while she's on her postnatal bleeding? Is she allowed? This is where we're going to discuss it, inshallah ta'ala, after the Isha prayer, inshallah ta'ala. We're going to discuss that بإذن الله الكريم. جزاكم الله خيرا. الحديث السادس عشرة, the 16th hadith. عن عبد الله بن أبي بكر بن حزم أن في الكتاب الذي كتبه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لعمر بن حزم أن لا يمس القرآن إلا طاهر. رواه مالك في الموطأ وصححه ابن حبان. This hadith, عبد الله بن أبي بكر بن حزم, he says, the messenger wrote a letter, alayhi salatu wasalam, to who? Amr ibn Hazm. And the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he wrote inside this letter, Alla yamassa al-Qur'ana illa tahirun. No one should touch the Qur'an except what? Unless he's what? Unless he's tahir, he's what? He's pure. This hadith, whether it's authentic or not, scholars, they disputed one another. There's a big khilaf regarding its authenticity, but that which seems right is that this hadith is what? Sahih. Al-Sheikh Al-Albani mentions in his kitab Irwa' al-Ghalil. Al-Albani goes extensively in details regarding it. So the hadith is what? It's sahih, alhamdulillah. There's nothing to worry about. But the discussion is, this hadith says that you can't touch the Qur'an unless you're what? You're pure. This term, pure, it's called lafdun mushtarak. It's a term that takes more than one meaning. That's why there's a khilaf here. It's a lafd which is mushtarak. Mushtarak here means what? Some scholars understood it as أَلَّا يَمَسَّ الْقُرْآنَ, that no one can touch the Qur'an إِلَّا طَاهِرٌ, يَعْنِي إِلَّا مُؤْمِنٌ, That the only one who can touch a mushaf is a what? It's a believer. Because Allah referred to the disbelievers as what? إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ نَجَسٌ. That the non-Muslims are what? The najas. The najasa here doesn't mean that the disbeliever is filthy on his body. It means what? His belief is filthy. Are we all together? His aqidah is what? Filthy. So they said that this hadith here means أَلَّا يَمَسَّ الْقُرْآنَ إِلَّا طَاهِرٌ. And the evidence that they used was that when Abu Huraira, the messenger, saw him in a road, and when the messenger was with him, and Abu Huraira, he left the messenger, he ran away from the Prophet, and he went home and he what? He purified himself. And then the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw Abu Huraira again, and he said, why did I not see you? Where were you? Where did you go? And he said, Ya Rasulullah, I was not in a state of tahara. And then the messenger said to him, إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنَ لَا يَنْجُسْ. A believer cannot be impure. Are we all together? So this hadith, أَلَّا يَمَسْ. I want to answer this question every time it's asked. Can a woman touch the Qur'an while she's on her menstruation? Today you're having an explanation, so pay attention. Brothers, if you're on a what? If you're in janabah, can you touch the mushaf? That question is always asked, right? Here today we're explaining it, pay attention. So you don't ever need to ask anyone. Are we all together? And that this question doesn't keep coming back. So this hadith has become a question. The tahara in this hadith, what is it referring to? Is it referring to the tahara which is hadathul asghar wal akbar, the major and minor impurity that happened to the believer, which is past wind, or hayd and nifas, or janaba? These are what? Major impurity. Is it referring to that? Or is it referring to the impurity of belief? Is that question, is that point understood? Let me repeat that one more time. This hadith says that no one can touch the Quran unless he's pure. Pure. Okay. This pure, what does it mean? It can take 2 minutes for, based on the Quran and the Sunnah. Is it talking about the purity of major and minor impurity? What's major and minor impurity? Minor impurity is what? If you pass wind, if you go to the toilet and urinate, this is a what? Minor impurity. Because you have to do what? Wudu. Anything you need to do wudu for is a what? Minor impurity. And anything that necessitates ghusl is called a what? Major impurity. So is this hadith saying that type? Or is it referring to the taharatul aqadi, the aqidah related tahara? Which is that if you're a believer, you can touch a mushaf whichever state that you're in. This is a dispute. And that which seems strongest is this hadith is referring to the iman. And it's not referring to major or minor impurity. So what does that take us to? Huh? What does that bring us to? It brings us to that the woman, if she's on her menstruation, she can touch the mushaf. And if the man is on a what? He's on a major impurity as well, he can touch that? That view is the strongest. According to me, of course, and the scholars that agree with me, such as Al-Imam Al-Muzani, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Are we all together? Ibn Hazm, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Abu Dawood Al-Zahiri, rahimahullahu ta'ala. And Sheikh Muhammad Nasir al-Din al-Albani. They push that opinion that here is what? It's talking about aqidah related issue. Because when the messenger sent this letter, he gave it to this companion and he sent it to him. It was in Yemen and they weren't Muslims. So he was saying to him, أَلَّا يَمَسَّ الْقُرْآنَ. Don't let the Qur'an be touched by the non-Muslims. It's not talking about the Muslims aslan. But my Sheikh who wrote this book, We had this discussion. I told you I'm going to explain your book and I'm not going to agree with this hadith the way you did istidlal of it. Because he believes, the Sheikh believes, what does he believe? He believes that it's talking about the woman who's on her menstruation or the man who's on his. So pay attention here. If this hadith has not proven the argument, what do you go back to? What we go back to is the asal, the woman was allowed to touch the mushaf whichever state she was in. The people who say she can't, they have to bring the evidence. لأن البراءة الأصلية the default position is a believer can read and touch the Mus'haf if he or she wishes. The one who says, no, she can't, he has to provide us with what? The evidence that they brought is two. This one, and we responded to it. The second one that they brought is the ayah in the Quran, لا يمسه إلا المطهرون. They said, this is our evidence. لا يمسه, no one touches it, إلا المطهرون, except that which, the one who's pure. We say, this is referring to the Lawh al-Mahfuz, not this Quran. It's referring to the Lawh al-Mahfuz, that the angels are pure and they're the only one who touch it. Does that make sense? So again, we're going back to the Bara'atul Asliya, which is the default position, is that the woman is allowed to touch the Mus'haf until proven otherwise. Am I making sense here? Huh? I want to be pulled to the side later and say, can I talk to you? Can I ask a question? I'm bringing my arguments now. If you think what I brought is strong, take it. If you don't, then and you see the other side and you think the other side is stronger, you can always come to my class, but you're entitled to. It's a difference of opinion which is valid. Both parties are praiseworthy. Are we all together? Great scholars hold this view, and great scholars what? Hold this view, lacking one is right. And that's subjective, what's right and what's wrong, to everyone is different, sah? Are we all together? So based on what I said, a woman, she is allowed to touch the Mus'haf what? In any state that she is in. Even that though I say that, I will still say to the sisters, if you're on your menstruation, avoid touching the Mus'haf. Just avoid it. To respect the Quran. وَمَن يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. Honor the Quran. Venerate the Quran. That's from, only from that angle. But if you touch it, you're not sinning. Are we all together? Because all of those evidence I brought, the proof I brought here is what? The Bara'atul Asliya. The default position. There's no evidence to prove otherwise that the woman can't touch it. Are we all together? Yeah? And not to mention, when the woman's on her menstruation is when her iman is the lowest. And is the time she most needs the book of Allah Azza wa Jal. Are we together? And now, the people who hold this opinion that she can't touch the Mus'haf, they're now in a dilemma. Why? What's the dilemma? Technology's come out. The iPad, it's got Mus'haf in there. What about when it turns into a Mus'haf? Does she have to drop the tablet? Or the phone, is she not allowed to hold it? All of that wouldn't have come if they just believed that it can be touched. Are we all together? The other issue is, can she read the Quran without touching it? If I've said that she can touch the Mus'haf, then I would definitely say what? She can read it. Are we all together? So I don't have to provide any evidence to show that she can touch the Mus'haf, or she can read the Quran. The asr is she can. She's a believer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions those who recite the Quran. The Quran is touched. Anyone who says no, there's an exception here. She can't touch it when she's on her menstruation. He has to bring evidence. Are we all together? And if all of those evidence are responded to, we go back to the asr, which is that she's allowed. Does that make sense? Even that though Abu Hanifa, and Imam Malik, and Imam Shafi, and Imam Ahmed all said she can't touch it. Are we all together? Before Imam said that she can't touch it. The overwhelming majority of scholars said she can't touch it. What? Jumhur Ahl al-Ilm said she can't touch it. Like in what's more beloved to us? Sheikh Abdul Aziz Baz, he said she can't touch it. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen said she can't touch it. But Sheikh Albani said, this is not democracy where we look at number, huh? What we really look at is, and اطمأنت إلي قلبي, wallahi, is there's no strong evidence on the side of those who say she can't. But the only thing that scares me personally of this opinion that I hold is the overwhelming majority of great, powerful scholars. I'm going to read a couple of statements on you to show you that that side who believe you can't touch it have a very powerful point. Let's read this one. Ibn Abd al-Barr, he brought ijma'. What did Ibn Abd al-Barr say? He brought ijma'. There's no difference of opinion, he said. I'm only mentioning this because it's fair, right? That I mentioned both sides. Ibn Abd al-Barr, he says, وَلَمْ يَخْتَلِفِ الْفُقَهَا وَلَمْ يَخْتَلِفْ فُقَهَاءِ الْأَمْصَارِ بِالْمَدِينَةِ وَالْعِرَاقِ وَالشَّامِ أَنَّ الْمُصْحَفَ لَا يَمَسُّهُ إِلَّا طَاهِرٌ عَلَى وُضُوءٍ وَهُوَ قَوْلُ مَالِكٍ وَالشَّافِعِي وَأَبُو حَنِيفَةَ وَالثَّوْرِي وَالْأَوْزَاعِي وَأَحْمَدُ بْنُ حَنْبَلٍ وَإِسْحَاقُ بْنُ رَاوِيَةَ وَأَبُو ثَوْرٍ وَأَبُو عُبَيْدٍ وَهَؤُلَاءِ الْأَئِمَّةِ الْفِقْهِ وَالْحَدِيثِ فِي أَعْصَارِهِمْ. All of them shikhat. I was together. And he said, وَلَمْ يَخْتَلِفْ فُقَهَاءُ الْأَمْصَارِ. The fuqaha did not differ. Ajib, right? Ibn Rajab said as well in Fathul Bari, Sharh Sahih al-Bukhari, he said, هَذَا قَوْلُ جَمَاهِيرُ الْعُلَمَاءِ وَرُوِيَ ذَلِكَ عَنْ عَلِيٍّ وَسَعْدٍ وَابْنُ عُمَرٍ وَسَلْمَانٍ وَلَا يُعْرَفُ لَهُمْ مُخَالِفٌ مِنَ الصَّحَابَةِ. The Sahabas didn't differ on this issue. He said, all of them said, he can't touch it. That scares you. Two quotes, yeah? Sah, big, on this side. And here is what? Those who say? So, at the minimum we can say, the minimum, the qawl of Ibn Abd al-Barr and Ibn Rajab, the reason why it's not strong in a sense is because they both claimed ijma' and kharqul ijma'. To break ijma' means I have to just bring one companion. Sah? When somebody claims ijma', the way to break their ijma' is just to bring one person who went against it. And there's no ijma' anymore. All it becomes is what? Jumhur, overwhelming majority. Sah? Are you with me? Am I making sense here? So the person who went against this ijma' is Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Does that make sense? But what we can't say no to is the overwhelming majority of the scholars, they say she can't touch it. So what we say to the sister is, avoid touching the mushaf. Avoid it. And read it from what? Read it from memory without touching it. Are we all together? Or those who say that she can't touch it, they say gloves and she can wear it, or she can grab it with something as long as she doesn't come into contact with it. وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. But to be on the safe side, avoid it. To purify or honor the Quran. Yeah? We'll take questions later, inshaAllah ta'ala. الْحَدِيثُ السَّابِعَ عَشَرَ. But has this issue giving you a bit of an insight now? Now you choose your side. Whichever of those two you like, that's your choice. Okay. عن المهاجر ابن قنفذ أنه سلم على رسول الله. المهاجر ابن قنفذ, he gave salams to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said to the Prophet, As-salamu alaykum. وَهُوَ يَتَوَضَّعَ. And the Prophet was doing what? Wudu. فَلَمْ يَرُدَّ عَلَيْهِ حَتَّى تَوَضَّعَ. The Messenger didn't respond to him. He ignored him. The Prophet finished his wudu and then he said to him, وَعَلَيْكُمُ السَّلَامُ. Then he told him, إِنَّهُ لَمْ يَمْنَعُنِي. Nothing prevented me. أَنْ أَرُدَّ عَلَيْكَ, to respond to your salams. إِلَّا أَنِّي كَرِهْتُ أَنْ أَذْكُرَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا عَلَىٰ طَهَارَةٍ. I only want him to mention Allah's name in purity. So the Shaykh is pushing the point what? Be careful. So when the Prophet ﷺ said, كَرِهْتُ, I dislike, does it show it's haram? Huh? No, it just shows that he didn't like it. So we say it's disliked. Stay away from it. To touch the mushaf whilst you're in a state of impurity. And avoid it. To even read it, try to avoid it. الحديث الثامن عشرة. حديث 18. وعن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها. عائشة قالت, she said, قال لي رسول الله, the messenger said to me, قال لي رسول الله, the messenger said to me, ناولني, give me الخمرة. عائشة, pass over to me that mat from the masjid. Give it to me. من المسجد. عائشة, get me that mat from the masjid. قالت عائشة, she said, فقلت, I responded. Meaning, the messenger was what? In the masjid. And she was what? In the house. And you know the Prophet's house was close to the masjid. The Prophet said, give me that mat, Aisha. And the Prophet was in the masjid. And she said, إِنِّي حَائِضٌ. I'm in a state of what? Menstruation. فقال, he then said to her, إن حيضتك ليست في يدك. Your menstruation is not in your hand. In other words, what she was trying to say was, I can't come in. So the sheikh is trying to take from here that the woman should not what? She shouldn't go into the masjid. If she's on her what? Menstruation. Some scholars, they understood the opposite from that hadith. They used the axe and the fiqh was the opposite that they understood from it. Which is that Aisha, her understanding, the Prophet corrected it. And he said to her, the hayd is not on your hand, come in. He said to her, the menstruation is not in your hand. Some of the fuqaha, like Imam al-Bayhaqi in his Sunan al-Kubra, he said, if the woman fears, and Imam Muzani mentions in the Mukhtasar as well, if the woman, the menses is dripping from her, she's not allowed to enter the masjid. La shakka, it's a darar on the masjid. It's a harm towards the masjid. But if there isn't that fear, she is permitted to go into the masjid. And she's allowed to sit in the masjid even if she's on her. This is another issue disputed amongst her. And it's best that the woman avoids it. What is it? It's best that the woman avoids it. وعن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها عائشة said أن فاطمة that فاطمة بنت أبي حبيش كانت تستحاض. She had menstruation. فسألت النبي, she asked the prophet about this issue. فقال, he said to her, ذلك عرق. She asked the prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم about the continuous bleeding. She asked him about him. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to her, ذَلِكَ عِرْقٌ, that's a vein. He replied by saying, it's a vein. عِرْق is a vein, أما, a blood clot. That's all it is, nothing big. وَلَيْسَتْ بِالْحَيْضَةِ, it's not menstruation. Meaning, the continuous bleeding, it's a blood that's coming from your vein. It's a fresh blood. Whereas the حيض is from the womb, it's different. فَإِذَا أَقْبَلَتِ الْحَيْضَةُ, when your menstruation comes, فَدَعِ الصَّلَاةَ, leave the prayer. وَإِذَا أَدْبَرَتْ, when it leaves, فَاغْتَسِلِي وَصَلِّي. The woman who's on istihada, I didn't mention something, which is that she has to do ghusl for every prayer. Sunnatan. And obligatory is wudu. We're going to see that later, inshallah ta'ala. The اغتسال for her to do غسل is sunnah. Like in the wudu for every prayer is what? Wajib. Because the Prophet ﷺ told her, وَتَوَضَّئِ وُضُوءَكِ لِلصَّلَاةِ. Do a what? Do wudu for it like the prayer. And to do غسل for every prayer is a sunnah, highly recommended for her. We talked about what istihada means, right? Now, we discussed that. عن فاطمة رضي الله تعالى عن فاطمة ابن أبي حبيش رضي الله عنها, she أنها كانت تستحاض, حي استحاض used to happen to her. فقال لها النبي, the messenger said to her, إذا كان دم الحيضة, if it's the menstruation blood, فإنه أسود, it's black. The menstruation blood is what? It's black. يعرف, it can be recognized. There's three ways that the menstruation can be recognized. One, the color. The color. Two, the density, the weight. It's heavier than the what? The other blood. Three, the smell. Those three. فَإِذَا كَانَ ذَلِكَ فَأَمْسِكَ عَنِ الصَّلَاةِ. If you recognize it because of its dark color, then he said to her, فَأَمْسِكَ عَنِ الصَّلَاةِ. Hold back from the prayer. فَإِذَا كَانَ الْآخَرُ, if it's the istihada, فَتَوَضَّئِ وَصَلِّي, do wudu and pray. فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ عِرْقٌ, all it is, it's just a vein. If it's hayd, hold from the prayer, don't pray. If it's istihada, what did he say? He said to her, do wudu and pray. So every salah she has to do what? Ibn Raslan, he has a sharah on what? He has a sharah on Sunan Abi Dawood, the great Shafi'i scholar. And At-Tibiyu, both of them, they said three things she can recognize the hayd from. What is it? Color, the smell and the density. If the woman can't recognize the hayd from the istihada, what did we call her? What she call it? Mutahayyira, she's confused. So then she follows what? The closest sisters, her sister, whoever she's with, family members. She follows them. عن عروة بن الزبير قال حدثتني فاطمة بنت أبي حبيش أنها أمرت أسماء أو أسماء حدثتني أنها أمرتها فاطمة بنت أبي حبيش أن تسأل رسول الله فأمرها أن تقعد الأيام التي كانت تقعد ثم تغتسل. This hadith, what does it state? The same point, which is عروة بن الزبير. عروة was who? عروة بن الزبير. Aisha was his auntie, his maternal auntie. So he used to enter onto her without her hijab. Because his mother was who? Asma bint Abi Bakr. So that's one of the benefits that he had. He would go and he would ask any questions he wanted his auntie. And Aisha was a what? She was a faqih. ولذلك الإمام الزركشي has a kitab called, he called it استدراكات عائشة على بعض الصحابة. Aisha catching our other companions. Times they did mistakes, she said, you're wrong. Where did you get that from? Are you with me, brothers? استدراكات عائشة على بعض الصحابة. بدرالدين الزركشي wrote it. Some places where Aisha would what? She would correct other companions. Or sometimes they would even what? They would come to her to find out. ولذلك one time Abdullah ibn Umar and some group of companions, they came to her. And then when they came, she was a very serious woman. Very serious. So they came and Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, Ibn Umar, you haven't been seen in a long, long time. And then Abdullah ibn Umar, he responded, he said, Zid ghibban tazdid hubban. Increase in absence and the hearts find love towards one. We miss one another. If a person's every day in your face, yeah, you see him every morning, look, he's on your doorstep. And you're meeting him every day. Yeah. What happens? You won't miss the person. Sometimes it's good to not see each other. Then the Sahaba started to talk. Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, hurry up, ask the question that you came for. You guys have any questions or what you came for? Ask. And she used to have a big curtain between them and her. There was a what? Big curtain. Radiallahu ta'ala anha. And this woman was a very righteous, pious woman. Radiallahu ta'ala anha, Aisha. When Abu Bakr, look at this story, the Prophet died. When the Prophet died, he got buried where? In the house. Because prophets are never buried somewhere else. Prophets are buried where they died. Then Abu Bakr died. Where was he buried? Right next to the Prophet. And then Umar, when he was on his deathbed, he commanded that they go and they ask Aisha if he could be buried right next to Abu Bakr and the Prophet. And then Aisha said, I was preparing this place for myself. This is the place I wanted next to my dad and my husband. But she said, I let you, Umar. I will give it to you. No problem. Are we all together? She said, I will let you, Umar. Then Umar said, she might have said this out of respect for me. When I die, verify, ask her again. If she says no, take me to Baqir. She might have said that because she respects me and I'm the Amir al-Mu'mineen and pressure might have made her say yes. So ask her again when I die. What do you do? Ask her a second time and see if she allows it. If she doesn't, then take me to Baqir. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, no, I said it. When he died and he was taken, she said, of course, I promised him. So Umar got placed in where? Inside the house. Aisha started wearing hijab. She covered her head. Top, tip, from the tip of her hair to every part she used to cover up. Is Umar alive? Can Umar see her? Shy. That's how she was, radiallahu ta'ala, anha. And you compare that to those who leave the house without no hijab. Huh? So these are the role models that, wallahi, sisters have to have. Aisha radiallahu anha, Urwa ibn Zubayr, that's his auntie. He said, حدثتني فاطمة. فاطمة بنت أبي حبيش told me, أنها أمرت أسماء, she commanded أسماء. أسماء حدثتني, or أسماء told me, أنها أمرتها فاطمة, that she commanded فاطمة بنت أبي حبيش, أن تسأل رسول الله, to ask the messenger of Allah. فأمرها, to ask the Prophet her situation. We already know what her situation was, right? The Shaykh is just repeating the same hadith. فأمرها أن تقعد الأيام. The Prophet told her, the days where you're on your menstruations, don't pray, don't do nothing. As for the days you're on your hayd, go and pray and do wudu. الحديث الحادي والعشرون. حديث what? Sorry, slowly. What number is it? الثاني والعشرون. The numbers are confusing now. الحديث الثاني والعشرون. The 22nd حديث. وعن عائشة, عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت, she said, دخلت أسماء, أسماء entered على رسول الله, the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقالت, she said, يا رسول الله, O messenger of Allah, كيف تغتسل إحدانا, how does one of us purify herself إذا طهرت من المحيضة, when she wants to cleanse herself, clean herself from what? Menstruation. How should she do it? What way should she do ghusl? قَالَ, the Prophet said, تَأْخُذُ سِدْرَهَا. The woman, she will take what? She will take sidr. Sidr today is like a soap. خلاص. Huh? Sidr is like a what? Sidr is seeds that are taken from the tree. It's meant to make the person smell nice. And today, we can exchange it with what? Soap. She takes her soap and her وَمَاءَهَا, and water. And she cleans herself with it. The purpose behind it is what? Then she what? So the woman washes her hand. Then she does wudu. فَتَوَبَّأُ. She purifies herself. ثُمَّ تَغْتَسِلُ رَأْسَهَا. So the wudu goes what? The wudu goes what? The wudu goes first. The person does wudu. Here is a discussion amongst the ulama. Does she do the legs or does she leave the legs to the end? Are we together? Both are present in the nusus. That this was done once, some narrations mention this and some narrations mention this. No problem. Whether she does the full wudu and then the ghusl, or she does all of the wudu and she leaves the legs and then she does the ghusl and then she does the leg after that, both are present. How does she then do the ghusl? ثم تغتسل رأسها. She washes her hair. She washes her what? The head. This ghusl is not only for the women, it's for the men as well, from janaba. وتدلكه. Dalk means she runs the water through the what? Remember this point. Sexual intercourse, the woman doesn't have to wash her hair. After the ghusl of what? The ghusl of sexual intercourse, the woman does not have to wash her hair. Lakin hayd, does she have to? If she plaited her hair, sisters, you have to learn this, this is important. If a woman has sexual intercourse with her husband and she has to do ghusl for the prayer, right? Does she have to open her, the plaits in her head? No, she doesn't have to. She can just wipe over her head without having to open it. We'll see the evidence for that. Lakin, if it's hayd, what does she have to do? She has to open everything and plait her hair. Because this one's frequent, this one isn't. This is rare, it happens. Are we all together? So she has to unplait her hair and she washes it. Until she makes the water reach what? The roots, usulu sha'riha. The foundations, when she's, this is hayd. ثم تفيض على جسدها. Because remember, there are other evidence that show that the women don't unplait their hair. How do we reconcile between them? We say this is hayd and this is what? Janaba. وَالْجَمْعُ وَاجِبٌ مَتَى مَا أَمْكَنَا إِلَّا فَلِلْأَخِيرِ نَسْخِ بُيِّنَا. We have to bring the evidence together as much as we can, instead of strengthening one over the other. ثم تفيض على رأسها. So once she washes her head, what does she then do? She pours the water over her body. It's recommended that she does it on the right side on her hair first. When she washes her hair, she does the right and then she does the left. And when she washes the body, it's recommended that she does the right. And then, based on the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, where she said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعجب التيمم في تنعله وترجله وطهوره وفي شأن كله. So she washes the first this side, and then she puts her head, her hands into this one, and then the right part of her body, and then she does the left like that. And if she doesn't, and she just throws the water all over herself, no problem. No problem. This is recommended. ثم تفيض على جسدها. She pours the water over her body. ثم تأخذ فرصتها فتطهر بها. Then she should take a piece of cloth. The woman should take a what? A piece of cloth. This cloth should be cotton or wool or whatever, it doesn't matter. And purify with it. Meaning her private part. قالت يا رسول الله. She said, يا رسول الله, O Messenger of Allah, كيف تطهر بها? How do I purify myself from it? She wanted more explanation. The messenger was shy now. Remember, he just mentioned the cloth and the wool, and that's he stopped there. He just used the cloth. Asma was like, how? The messenger was very shy. This teaches us a good characteristic, which is, even if something is true and you have to say it sometimes, you should have haya. Speaking about vulgar things, bad things, and saying it, it's not permissible. Aisha then says, فَعَرَفْتُ الَّذِي يَكْنِي عَنْهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. I realized from the Prophet's face what he was metaphorically, what he was trying to point towards, I recognized it. فَقُلْتُ, I said, on behalf of the messenger, تَتَبَّعِينَ آثَارَ الدَّمْ. Just follow the way the blood came from. The Prophet was shy, he couldn't say it. So Aisha, this shows us another thing, which is a woman should know her husband. Yeah, a woman should have fiqh of knowing her husband the way he is. A man is shy and she brings him food, for example, and the food stands in his throat and he's looking at her like this. He doesn't want to say to her, go in the kitchen, get me water or something. The woman should be wise and understand the man's about to die. And understand her husband. Shows she's a akhira. Yeah, ikhwa, it's important. Al-hadith al-thalith wal-ishroon. The hadith 23. وعن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت, she said, قال رسول الله, the messenger said, دعي عمرتك وانقضي رأسك وامتشطي وأهلي بحج. عائشة said that the messenger said to her, delay your umrah and undo وانقضي رأسك, your hair, open it up. وَمْتَشِطِي, and comb your hair. وَأَهِلِّي بِحَجٍ, and do ihram for hajj. Here we have to understand the fiqh that is taken from this hadith is that the hair needs to be open for the woman when the ghusl is done. That we took from the previous hadith. عن أم عطية رضي الله عنها. أم عطية رضي الله عنها وكانت, she was بايعت النبي, she gave pledge of allegiance to the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. قالت, she said, كنا لا نعد الكدرة والصفرة بعد الطهر شيئا. We would not take into consideration the brown and the yellow fluid after the purification. The woman, after the hayd finishes, a brown and a yellow fluid comes from her. This is not considered to be part of the hayd. She's pure, no problem. Don't consider this to be anything. That's just a normal discharge. Okay? It's a dark, black, it's brown, or it's yellowish. She said that we never used to consider this, and we never used to give it any, we consider that just to be a normal discharge. Meaning this is not hayd. This is not, it's not hayd. But this is referring to after she purifies herself, right? Like inside the hayd, that's a different ruling. وَأَنْ أُمِّ عَلْقَمَةَ مَوْلَى عَائِشَةَ. أُمِّ عَلْقَمَةَ, she was a slave girl for who? عَائِشَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهَا. أَنَّهَا قَالَتَ, she said, كَانَ النِّسَاءُ, the woman, يبعثنا إلى عائشة. They will send to عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها بالدرجة فيها الكسرف فيه الصفرة من دم الحيضة. They used to send little boxes and inside this there were cloths in it, different colors. They wanted to know, is this part of the hayd or not? And Aisha would look into it. This shows us the need that we have for women to be ones to do this. A woman who knows fiqh very well, who when the women come to her, they can show her things that men can't see. Things that a woman will be shy to talk to about a sheikh with or a da'i. Are we all together? And you brothers need to study so you can answer them for your wife. Or else are you going to tell the sheikh to call your wife to call the sheikh? Are we all together, brothers? And sit there and just listen to the sheikh, give a verdict to your wife. No, study, learn. Study. Learn these issues so when it comes in your household, you are the one who can deal with it. And number one, the woman should learn it for herself. She should what? She should learn these for herself. And the fact that we need a sister who studies these issues very well, that she can respond and help the sisters in these issues and the women in these issues. So they used to send it to Aisha and they would ask her, hey, what does she think about this? Is this part of the hayd or not? And Aisha would say in response, is this from the damul hayda? Is this, does she have to pray? And Aisha would say, لا تعجلنا, don't hasten women, حتى ترين القصة البيضاء, until you see a white discharge, don't hasten, until you see that, تريد بذلك الطهر من المحيضة, until you see the pure cleanliness, don't. وعن أم سلمة, أم سلمة, she said, جاءت أم سليم إلى رسول الله. أم سليم, she came to the messenger. فقالت, she said, يا رسول الله, O messenger of Allah, إن الله لا يستحي من الحق. Allah is not shy from the truth. فهل على المرأة من غسل إذا احتلمت. If a woman, she has a wet dream and fluid comes from her. First she said, يا رسول الله, Allah is not shy of what? Allah is not shy of the truth. She started with that ayah. So, meaning she's going to ask her what? Are you with me, brothers? The ayah indicates that it's something to be shy about. But she said, don't be shy, O Messenger of Allah. I need to know this. And shyness, what does it do, brothers and sisters? It prevents a person from learning. The scholars, they said, المستحي والمتكبر لا يتعلمان. The shy and the arrogant, they never learn. Aisha said, رحم الله النساء الأنصار. Aisha said, may Allah have mercy upon the women of Ansar. لم يمنعهن الحياء. Shyness did not prevent them from learning the religion. It didn't stop them. They learned it. They came to the Prophet and they asked. Okay? So ask, if you have an issue, don't let shyness prevent you from learning. Ask, find out. So what did she ask? She said, if a woman has wet dreams, she sees something in her dream. And the scholars, they say, it means she sees intimacy in a dream. And then fluid comes from her, man or woman. What should she do in this situation? قال النبي, the messenger said, إِذَا رَأَتِ الْمَاءَ. So sometimes the person may have a wet dream or may see something in their dream, but when they wake up, nothing is there. There's nothing upon you. There's nothing upon you. All you just need to look at is what came from you. So if the woman, and even if you don't remember a wet dream, but you see fluid, you're like, where did this come from? And you don't remember a dream. What do you have to do? You still have to do wusul. Doesn't matter. The fluid is what determines everything. فَغَطَّتْ أُمُّ سَلَمَةَ تَعْنِي وَجْهَهَا. Look at Ummu Salama. When she asked the question, what did she do? She covered? Some of the scholars use this to say, is the face of the woman? Is it awrah? Does the woman have to cover her face? Was Ummu Salama's face showing at this moment or not? Huh? Why are you not answering the question, brothers? Yeah? I'm of the opinion it's wajib for the woman to cover her face. I'm of that opinion. I'm of the opinion that it's what? But how do you respond to this hadith? Question. Umm Salama, huh? What did he say? But if she was shy, why would she cover her face if her face was already covered? Should have been covered in the first place. Huh? But the messenger, she covered her face from the Prophet ﷺ. So she did. The reason why she was shy, she just asked a very a question that. So she covered her face. She became nervous. So if the niqab is wajib, she should have had her face covered. She shouldn't have to worry. Yeah. Brothers are confused here. We don't have all of that. That's the truth. This is before the ayatul niqab and hijab came. This is before the what? Before the ruling. Are we all together? Be careful. Like in this is a mas'ala. It's a khilafi issue. Like in the strongest opinion is that the woman's face is a what? Is the legs of the woman awra? Is her legs awra? Her foot, is it her feet? Is her feet? Is it awra? Yeah? What's more fitna, her legs or her face? Then the face, how would the Sharia then say that she has to cover her feet and not her face? Huh? Sheikh Albani said that's su'alun falsafi. What did he say? He said that's a philosophical argument. He said that doesn't. But Sheikh Albani is of the opinion that the face is not. He doesn't believe it's awra. He doesn't believe that. And he said, this is a philosophical answer. He said, if you guys ask me that, and I'll say the same thing to you. What is more fitna, her eyes or her cheek? Which was more of a fitna? He said, the eyes is. So why are you showing the eyes? Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah said that in his kitab, Jilbab al-Mar'at al-Muslimah. على كل حال, we need to take benefits from these ahadiths, because there's a lot of fiqh to take from it, and sometimes you have to think on these issues. Huh? You have to think. وقالت يا رسول الله, she said, O Messenger of Allah, وقالت يا رسول الله وتحتلم المرأة. The Prophet, she said, O Messenger of Allah, does a woman have a dream? The Prophet said, نعم, she does. He said, تربت يمينك فبما يشبهها ولدها. He said, yes, let your right hand be dusted. I'ma be put in dust. And that is why the son resembles his mother. What does he mean by that? It means that when the wife and the husband, they have intimate relationship, a fluid comes from the woman and it comes from the man. If that fluid comes from the woman first, then the child looks like the woman. Huh? And if it comes from the man first, what is it? That the child, he looks like the father. That's what the fuqaha mentioned. Medically, I don't know, but that's what they mentioned. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله, the messenger said, خير الصفوف الرجال أولها. The best line for the men is the what? What line is the best for the men? The front line. وَشَرُّهَا آخِرُهَا. The worst. Did I jump something? The brothers like this hadith, huh? You really want us to cover this hadith? Okay, we'll cover this hadith for you, brothers. وَعَنْ عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ بْنُ عَوْفٍ. عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ بْنُ عَوْفٍ, he said, رضي الله تعالى عنه, قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, إِذَا صَلَّتِ الْمَرْأَةُ خَمْسَهَا. If the woman prays her five daily prayers, وَصَامَتْ شَهْرَهَا, and she fasts in the month of Ramadan, وَحَفِظَتْ فَرْجَهَا, and she protects her private part, وأطاعت زوجها, and she obeys her husband. قيل لها وبستها ادخلي enter من أي الأبواب, whichever of the doors of Jannah you wish. الجنة الشئتي, you choose whichever of the 8 doors of Jannah. Jannah is 8 doors. Hellfire is how many? Hellfire is 7. Jannah is 8. It will be said to the woman, you choose whichever of those 8 doors of Jannah you want to enter from. But 5 things are needed from her. The first one is that she prays her salah, 5 daily prayers. She fasts the month of Ramadan. She protects her private part, and she what? She obeys her husband. وَأَطَاعَتْ زَوْجَهَا. She obeys him. She listens to him. You see, obedience is obligatory on the side of the woman. Are we all together? A woman has to obey her husband. واجب. She's sinning if she doesn't do what her husband tells her to do. If her father commands her and her husband takes precedence. شَرْعًا. The husband takes precedence even over her father. Very vital. Are we all together? وَأَطَاعَتْ زَوْجَهَا. And she obeys her husband. She listens to him. Huh? وَأَطَاعَتْ. And she obeys زَوْجَهَا. قِيلَ لَهَا. It will be said to the woman, أُدْخُلِي أَنْتَ مِنْ أَيِّ أَبْوَابِ. Whichever of the doors of Jannah you wish. You're free. You choose. Meaning, she's so guaranteed Jannah that she can choose whichever she wants. الحديث الثامن والعشرون, the 28th hadith. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the messenger said, خير صفوف الرجال, the best line for the men is which one? أولها, which one? The front line is the best for the men. وشرها, and the worst line for the men is which one? آخرها, the last. وخير صفوف النساء, which line is the worst for the women? Which one? So the first is the worst for them, and the best one is for them is what? The last. وَشَرُّهَا أَوَّلُهَا. Why? At the time of the messenger, there was no barrier between the men and the women. So the men and the women, they could see. If the man looked back, he could see the woman. Are we all together? So the last line for the man would be next to the what? And the more closer you are to the women, the closer you are to fitna. We're all together. The closer you are to what? Fitna. ولذلك there's a kitab called طرق الحكمية. طرق الحكمية في السياسة الشرعية, written by Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyya. It talks about Islamic politics. You know what he said? He said governments go down. Governments go because of free mixing. Free mixing destroys constitutions, governments. It goes, Allah collapses it. It's dangerous. Free mixing, the consequences of it is great. We've seen it with our own eyes. People come to me on a regular basis, and there are cases of rape on women. Or if you look at it, it's because of free mixing. In the household, a cousin who was not meant to be in that position, and a girl who was not, could have been divided. Fitna came from it. And when Allah's commands are gone against, this is the consequences that are bad. To be very vigilant in our children and our household, who comes in and who leaves. He's your uncle, don't worry, he'll take you. La la la, shara la yajuz. He's a far uncle. Where's the uncle? Because he's a tribe. This is a problem. Cousins, where is the cousin? Dad's uncle's friend's neighbor. That's the cousin. Ajib. And he's in the house with the wife and his children and everything. And then later, problems come from it. Are we all together? Ya ikhwa, this religion came to protect our honor. It came to protect our women, our children. It came to protect our issues. Are we all together? Your brother is living in your house, and sometimes you're leaving him in the house with your wife. Shara alayya Jews, who permitted this for you? I trust my brother. I know I trust my brother, but I don't trust shaitan. Are we all together, brothers? For anyone, let them look at you as though you came from a different world. Let them see you as that. That's more better for you than the evil consequences that will come from this, wallahi. That's something you need to keep in mind. Divide the children. Don't mix with the opposite gender. Don't let them stay together in room alone. Shaytan will not give up. And he will make sure he brings corruption here. He wants family members to not sit under the same table, fitna, fasad. So wallahi, follow the sharia. This religion is going to look after us. It's going to take good care of us if we follow it, if we do as we should. وعن أم عطية رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت أمرنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم The messenger commanded us أن نخرجهن That we bring the women out في الفطر والأضحى عيد الفطر Sorry والله I don't know why I'm jumping hadith Yeah وعن ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه عبد الله بن مسعود narrated قال قال رسول الله The messenger said إن المرأة عورة The woman is a what? She's a عورة This hadith shows she's all عورة Because it didn't say except So it's unrestricted Isn't it not? Unrestricted The woman is عورة Look فإذا خرجت If the woman leaves And she goes out What happens? استشرفها الشيطان Shaytan raises hopes of misguidance in her. He makes her seem like what she isn't. Are you with me? If this woman even did not look good, what would he do? He would make her look the best for everybody. Are you with me, brothers? Everybody, inshallah ta'ala, is good looking. Okay? But I'm saying that he would take something and make something out of it. He would, because he has a purpose behind it. وَأَقْرَبَ مَا تَكُونُ مِنْ وَجْشٍ رَبِّهَا وَهِيَ فِي قَعْرِ بَيْتِهَا She is never closer to Allah. وَأَقْرَبُ مَا تَكُونُ مِنْ وَجْشِ رَبِّهَا The time that she's most closest to Allah is when she stays in her house. The woman, the time she's most closest to Allah is when she stays at home. وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَ تَبَرُّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ الْأُولَى وَأَقِمْنَا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتِينَ الزَّكَاةَ وَأَطِعْنَا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ The women should just stay at home. Wallahi, this is good for you. I give you a prime example. The queen of the UK doesn't walk around on the streets. She doesn't. Wallahi, she doesn't. And guess what? The queen, no one's allowed to touch her. Even if she's not touched. Are you with me? And she gives you her four front fingers and she wears gloves. وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ They protect her. Are you with me, brothers? All of that. She's not like, you can't just jump on her. Islam, better than that, has given what? That to our women. Kept them at home, protected, cared for. Look, why can't a woman be happy that she's at home and a man's running around like a headless chicken? He's bringing money home. Huh? And he gives it to her. She should be happy. أليس كذلك? And he says, this is the money. صح brothers. Isn't that something to be happy about? Yeah? Wallahi it is. And you all seen this new hashtag that came out, which is called what? Me too, right? Huh? Where? Think about it. That's what they want. These are the people who say freedom. Wallahi, they don't want it. They just want these women to come out, and this is what they want to do to them. That's what they understand of. Let the woman come out and let her be done. Let them do this to her. These are the biggest countries in the world who claim what? Freedom. That's really what they want. And Islam is against that. You know what it is? They are jealous, we Muslims, they can't see our women. And their women are running around like this. But our women are protected and hidden for us. They're jealous. So it's like, why don't they come out? You're oppressing them. Bring them out for us so we can see them. Wallahi, that's what it is. Am I making sense? Wallahi, that's what it is. I want to see what you have at home. Wallahi, the most valuable things are the things that you don't see. Is it not true? Why is a rock on the earth, surface of the earth, different from a pebble? I mean, the jewels that are found, or the diamond that's found deep down, what's the difference? Aren't they both rocks? Are they both not rocks? What's the difference? The one on the top is a man, the diamond is a woman. Meaning, the man is all over the place. And the woman is hidden and she's covered and she's not seen. That's the value Allah gave her, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you take that away from yourself, you lose value. Wallahi, you lose value. The men who say the women should come out and in their head, deep down, they know that that's no value. They know deep down that that's not true. لكن they won't say it because استحوذ عليهم الشيطان. Shaitan has taken them. الحديث الثلاثون. The 30th hadith. وعن أم عطية رضي الله عنها قالت, she said, أمرنا رسول الله, the messenger commanded us, أن نخرجهن, that we bring the women out, في الفطر, عيد الفطر, and عيد الأضحى, we bring the women out, الأوائق والحيض وذوات الخدور, the women who are menstruating, the women who are in their inner chambers, all of them, and it's obligatory for every single person to come to عيد الفطر, even the woman who's on a menstruation, she has to come. Today is about number. It's about numbers. And everybody being there. The Muslims, that's what they have to do. Everyone comes. The woman on her menstruation, what does she do? She doesn't pray with the people. She sits on the side. But she comes. What does she do? She comes. The Prophet said, فَأَمَّا الْحُيَّضَ, the woman who's on her menstruation, فَيَعْتَزِلْنَا الصَّلَاةِ, they don't pray with the people. وَيَشْهَدْنَا الْخَيْرَ, and they what? They participate with khair. ولذلك, I remember Sheikh Abdul Muhsin رحمه الله تعالى, حفظه الله, still alive. He said something very good, which is a question that was asked, put to him. Sometimes you find men who see women standing somewhere when the salah is being prayed, and he says to her, why don't you pray? That's gharib. Man doesn't talk to a woman and say, come pray salah. Because the woman can come to the place where it's being prayed and she sits on the side and she doesn't pray. Because there's a udhur shar'i. Are we all together? So this is not your bab. Don't enter it. Don't enter it. Don't talk about it. Let them do what they're doing. وَيَشْهَدْنَا الْخَيْرَ, the women will come and they will participate with the good. وَدَعْوَةَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, قُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, look at the sahabiyat and how they were like. She said, إِحْدَانَا لَا يَكُونُ لَهَا جِلْبَابٌ, one of us doesn't have a jilbab. What did she do? He said, لِتُلْبِسَهَا أُخْتَهَا مِنْ جِلْبَابِهَا, let her sister share with her. Say, look, sister, here I've got a spare hijab in which I can give you. This is to show that she has to come. That emphasizes on the wujub. She's saying, I don't have it. Do I come? Yeah, you still have to come. What do? You borrow it. So that shows Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. If that's for the women who are on their menstruation, is it obligatory for the men to come? Eid al-Fitr is wajib for the men as well. Wajib, you have to come. Naam. Unless the concept of it coming with Friday is another niqash, it's another discussion. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the messenger said, ليس للنساء وساط الطريق, women, the middle of the road is not for women. A woman should never be walking in the middle of the road and she's walking, huh? عجيب. You see a woman walking right in the middle of the road and the men are going on the side around her. لا. The Prophet said, عليكم بحافات الطرق. The woman should be on the corners, on the side. The woman should hide herself. Are we together, sisters and brothers? The sisters have to conceal themselves. Even when they're on the road, they don't. And a sister will see another sister, and Amina, how are you? On the other side of the road. And she's talking to her. Now that you've come out because of a necessity, something necessary brought you out, stick to it being necessary. What do? Go out, hide yourself, do what you have to do. Come rushing back home. Don't stand in the middle of the road and start thinking and texting and messaging. And aslan, the woman's aslan is that she should hide herself. May Allah protect our women for us and honor them in this world and hereafter. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا يحل, it is not permissible لامرأة, a woman, تؤمن, who believes بالله, she believes in Allah, واليوم الآخر, and she believes in the day of judgment, تسافر, she should not travel مسيرة يوم, in the distance of one day and one night, إلا مع ذي محرم عليها, except with a mahram. This hadith, it shows what? What does it show? The duration of one day and one night. Another narration says she should not travel at all. The one that says she should not travel at all encompasses the rest under it. Even if it's 20 minutes, she's not allowed to. a woman should not travel and leave her land that she's in if she believes in Allah on the Day of Judgment. A woman should not travel. And the man should not let his wife just travel countries, destinations and distances. Should not. This is nas min Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the Prophet he said. Are we all together, brothers? This is not permissible. It's a darar, it's a harm when a woman travels by herself in that air. What could happen? What could go wrong? What could take place? Allahu alam. Are we all together? The woman should not travel. The Messenger said that alayhi salatu wasalam, la yahillu, it is not permissible. Limra'atin, a woman, tu'minu billahi. Does she believe in Allah? Does she believe in the Day of Judgment? She should not travel. Some scholars said that if there is a woman, if a man takes her from one side of the airport, or she's leaving from Dubai, and he takes her to the airport, and then on the other side, who's waiting for her? Her brother or her father or somebody. On the other side, then there's no problem, inshallah ta'ala. And if the journey is less than a day and night, some scholars, they said that there's no problem with this. There is a problem. What about if the plane goes to another destination? Change of route. Are we all together? For whatever reason, the fuel finished. I'm just saying, what about if something goes wrong, technical problem, and they say, you know what? We have to go to Hungary. And she was going to a different direction. Like, she has spent a day and night in a hotel by herself. Are we all together, brothers? This is not something good. It's not something good. A woman should avoid it. Stay away from this. I hope these ahkam, inshallah ta'ala, are not looked at as jazakallah khairah for telling us. Inshallah, we'll see if we would implement it or not. Fear Allah. Don't make these evidences proof against yourself. Inshallah, by doing this, inshallah, you find happiness. Open your heart and it will be easy for you, inshallah. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صنفان من أهل النار. Two types of characteristics of the people of the hellfire. لم أراهما, I have not seen them. The Messenger is saying, two types of people, I haven't seen them. Meaning, they're going to come in the what? The late آخر الزمن. They're going to be signs of the hour. I haven't seen them. It's not something that was present at the time of the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. Sinfani, two characteristics, two types of people. لم أراهما, I have never seen them. Who are they? قوم, a people. معهم سياط, they have what? Sticks. Lashes. كأذناب البقرة, كأذناب البقرة, it's like a what? The tail of a ha. يضربون بها الناس, they're whipping the people, police officers. What are they doing? Lashing people. Go to him, what are you doing? It's whatever is mentioned, pay attention, that is going to happen in an hour to come, doesn't show it's permissible and doesn't show it's not impermissible. Are we all together? So don't come and say, are police officers haram? No, it's not. The Prophet is just stating something that's going to... Are we all together? Just because the Prophet stated that this is going to happen, it doesn't mean it's halal or haram. But the other one is, which the Prophet is going to mention. Or are we together? We're going to mention it, with shart. This is talking about a people who are lashing people, ظُلْمًا وَعُدْوَانًا, unjustly, oppressing them, wronging them. Whips, and they are lashing and beating the people unjustly. That's going to be present. وَنِسَاءٌ, women, كَاسِيَاتٍ عَارِيَاتٍ, they are wearing clothing and they are naked. Ajib. They are wearing clothes, they have clothes on, and they're naked. How? Scholars mentioned two ways. Either the clothes is too tight, so everything can be seen. Or the clothing is see-through. See-through, you can see right through it. كاسيات عاريات. They're wearing clothes, but they're naked. Also what? مميلات مائلات. These women, they are inclined to, and they make their husband inclined to them. They're women who try to attract. رؤوسهن كأسنمة البخت. Their heads is like the hump of a camel. They make their hair high, stand. Shara'an is not permissible for a woman to wear a hijab and then she has her hair up. She's not allowed to. When she does her hijab, her hair has to go down. This indicates she's showing the people she's got a lot of hair. Does that make sense? Shara'a la yajuz. Are we all together where the Sharia talks about it? Ru'usuhunna, their head, is with hair that's high up. She puts her head, she makes a knot right at the top to give the inclination. This is how it is. كَأَسْنَمَةِ الْبُخْتِ الْمَائِلَةِ. And it's tilted. لَا يَدْخُلْنَا الْجَنَّةِ. These women will not enter Jannah. And the first group that was mentioned as well are not going to enter Jannah. وَلَا يَجِدْنَا رِيحَهَا. And they won't smell the fragrance of Jannah. وَإِنَّ رِيحَهَا. They will smell the fragrance of Jannah will be smelled from. لَا يُوجَدُ مِنْ مَسِيرَةِ كَذَا وَكَذَا. Meaning they will be so far from Jannah. Let alone entering Jannah. They won't even smell it. And they will be placed in a distance far from Jannah. إِنَّا لِلَّهُ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Allah, if Nabiullah Muhammad saw Instagram, if he saw Facebook, yeah, if he saw, what's it called, Snapchat, all this that's going on, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. This is normal now, صح? There's no hiding this, huh? مشكلة. Women have to watch how they dress. I advise you, because due to time we can't go through all of it, my plan was to go through it, but sisters, there are 7 conditions for a jilbab. If it does not meet those 7 conditions, it's not a hijab. Are we together? Go to the kitab, Jilbab al-Mar'at al-Muslima by Sheikh al-Albani. He mentions the 7. The whole book is about those 7 conditions for a jilbab. Hijab, if it doesn't meet those 7 conditions, it is not a hijab. Are we all together? From them being, it can't be tight. Also, it has to be hard. If a woman's wearing, it's worse, yeah? But it's silky. So it sticks on her skin and her body. It's not permissible. It has to be tough. So it doesn't stick on her body. It's not allowed. 2, 3, the woman is not allowed to wear colorful that attracts people. She's inside a group of sisters who are wearing black and she's got pink on. She's wearing a pink hijab or she's wearing a bright yellow hijab. Juice. It's not permissible. 4, it can't look like a men's clothes. 5, she can't wear a hijab that's made out of jeans. Methalan. Why? Because that falls under the tashabbuh al-kuffar, imitating the kuffar and whatnot. Whereas Calvin Klein and whatnot, hijab, or wearing a hijab that imitates the men's clothing. Are we all together? You see, men and women, when it comes to clothing, the texture, they both can be the same. Are we all together? Except the women have silk, the men don't. That's the only texture that men are not allowed. The difference between men and women's clothing is the form in which it's made, not the texture. Does that make sense? It's the form and the way it's made. Does that make sense? Are we all together? So Sheikh Albani mentions the 7. Go through it, inshallah ta'ala. He brings evidence for each one. Each one he mentions evidence for it. If it doesn't meet those conditions, then you know you're not wearing a what? You're not wearing a hijab. الحديث الرابع وثلاثون وعن أسامة بن زيد رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال كساني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قبطية كثيفة كانت مما أهداها دحية الكلب. أسامة بن زيد رضي الله تعالى عنهما, he said, the messenger of sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave me a thick material that was known as, it was known as qubtiyya, that was a clothing it was known as. And it was a clothing given to the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by the noble companion, dihyat al-kalbi. He gave it to the messenger as a gift. فَكَسَوْتُهَا مَرَأَتِهِ. This sahabi, he loves his wife, so he went and he gave it to his wife. What did he do? He went home and he gave it to his wife. He said, wear it, it's yours. فَقَالَ لِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, the messenger said to me, مَا لَكَ لَمْ تَلْبِسِ الْقُبْطِيَّ. Why did you not wear the qubtiyya that we were given as a gift? قُلْتُ, I said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ كَسَوْتُهَا مْرَأَتِي. I gave it to my wife. فَقَالَ لِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, the messenger said to her, said, مُرُهَا فَلْتَجْعَلْ تَحْتَهَا غِلَالَةً. Tell her to wear under it something, a غلالة, something, a lining or whatever, under it. إِنِّي أَخَافُ أَنْ تَصِفَ حَجْمَ عِظَامِهَا. Because the cloth, I know the way it was. I'm scared that it may what? Show her joints and her body parts and her figure. It might show her physique. I'm scared it might do that. So tell her to wear something under it. What does that show you? This shows you that the hijab that the woman is wearing cannot be something that sticks on her body. Now, it can't be tight, and even if it's not tight, but there are some hijabs that, what do? They stick on your skin, or they stick on your body, or it sits on your body. Whereas if it's hard, what happens? It goes out, and it doesn't stick to you. That's what's needed. You see? وعن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما ابن عباس he narrated قال he said لعن رسول الله the messenger cursed المتشبهين من الرجال بالنساء the men who imitate the women. Allah's curse is upon the man who tries to imitate a woman. Even if it's a joke and you're making your wife laugh, your curse of Allah is going to be upon you. Some men, what they do is they're joking with their wives and they wear hijab. And when they make the family laugh, لعن رسول الله the messenger cursed المتشبهين من الرجال بالنساء. You can't. Wearing makeup for men falls under this. Are we all together? Men plucking their eyebrows in feminine. Men doing what you call it, huh? All of this. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. لعن رسول الله the messenger cursed. What is لعن? الطرد من رحمة الله. Allah's mercy is distance from you. That's why some people are suffering. Allah's curse is distance from the mercy of Allah is not coming to this house. Also, what? والمتشبهات من النساء بالرجال. The women who are what? Dressing like men. Are we all together? She's wearing men's clothes in the house. She's taking her husband's clothes and she's wearing it. She's sharing his clothes with him. Dangerous. Because she took it from Hollywood. That she takes his t-shirts and she wears it. She takes his what? She wears it. لا يجوز. Falls under this hadith. Okay, brothers and sisters. Why are you all looking at me like that for? هذه أحكام. This is the rulings. These 42 hadiths are meant to change your lives, inshallah ta'ala. ليهلك من هلك عن بينة ويحيى من حي عن بينة. These ahadith are meant to know why we're suffering. صحيح. Wasn't that the promise? السادس وثلاثون 36 وعن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما أيضا أنه سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول he heard the prophet say لا يخلون a man should not be alone with a woman. Is a man talking to a woman over the phone, is it does it fall under this? لا والله he does. Being in a room with a woman alone is not permissible. Talking to her on the phone alone, it is not permissible. Same خلوة, it encompasses both. فتنبه لذلك. Keep that in mind. لا يخلون a man should not be alone with a woman. رجل بامرأة. ولا تسافرن a woman should not travel. امرأة إلا ومعها ذي محرم. Look at this hadith. This one is general. A woman cannot travel without a man. She can't. فقام رجل a man stood up. فقال he said يا رسول الله O Messenger of Allah اكتبت I was written في غزوتي كذا وكذا. I was written in the journey so and so. وخرجت امرأتي حاجة. My wife she's doing Hajj. And I was written in the battle so and so, meaning I can't go with her to Hajj. The messenger said, "Idhab, leave the battle. فحج مع امرأتي. Go to your wife, catch her and do Hajj with her." This shows that the woman cannot do Hajj without her mahram. Pay attention. Can a woman do Hajj without a mahram? Yeah? Can a woman do Hajj without a mahram? If you say no, then that means you believe that a mahram is from the conditions of Hajj. Is that what you believe? So you're saying that it's a shart for Hajj, that the man is a condition for the Hajj. We know Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says man istata'a ilayhi sabila, that we know is for everybody. So you're saying there's an extra additional condition for the woman? Yeah? So does that mean she can do Hajj without her husband? The scholars, they say Pay attention to this. Hajj is still upon her, but she can't travel. So she has to pay for somebody else to do it on her behalf. She has the money, she has the ability to go, but she doesn't have anyone to take her. She's not allowed to go. She funds somebody else, and somebody else does it for her. And I expanded this on in my sharh in Bulugh al-Maram, because Ibn Hajar brings this in Kitab al-Hajj. I went in great details. We don't have too much time now. Al-Hadith al-Sabi' wa thalathun. وعن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, the messenger said, أيما امرأة, any woman, نكحت, who gets married, بإذن, بغير إذن وليها, without the permission of her ولي, فنكاحها باطل, her nikah is null and void. Pay attention. Can a woman get married without the permission of her father? We're talking about a father that is a Muslim. If he's not a Muslim, he has no wilaya over the woman. We're talking about Muslim father. A Muslim father, if a girl goes and she gets married without her father's permission, she goes and she gets married, is that nikah sahih? No. That nikah is batil. But what about if they had children? Are those children awlad zina? Yeah. No. This is called nikah shubha. These children are fine, they're his children, there's nothing wrong, but the minute the ruling is told to him, if he carries on, he's zina now. Does that make sense? Like the Hanafis, the fiqh al-Hanafiyya, they believe that the woman can get married without the permission of a wali. Abu Hanifa said that, and he was wrong in this issue. Are you with me? So you tend to find, and you might come across, some individuals say to you, oh, my parents got married without their father's permission. They were in the UK and they met each other and they got married and khalas. They had me, and look at me, I'm 45 now. Now what should we do in this situation? Are you with me? We say, no problem, there's nothing wrong with what you're the son, mashallah, everything's right. This is called nikah shubha, bi ijma'il ulama. I made a video on this called the ruling on marrying without the permission of the guardian. I made a 5 or 6 part series on it, where I brought all the evidences and crossed it. And even if the woman is a widow, some people think if she's a widow, meaning her husband died, or she's a divorcee, they think she can marry herself off. No. She still needs the guardian to marry her off. Are we all together? The only difference is that the virgin, she's shy. When her father brings her brother for her, she's shy. She'll look around and say, oh, she's confused. But she wants it. But she can't say, Dad, I want it. Nowadays, they can. Things have changed, yeah? But back in those days, they were a bit shy. They would look down. Are you with me? Like in the widow, she went through marriage, automatically she'll say, I don't want this one. He's not the one I'm looking for. So she can speak for herself. That's the only difference. Lacking both of them, they need the permission of what? The guardian. And evidence for that is the story of Ma'qal ibn Yasar. Ma'qal ibn Yasar's sister got divorced by a man. When he divorced her, Ma'qal said to the man, I promise you, wallahi, you're never going to marry my sister. But watch. He went, I'm never going to give you my sister again. You can because what happened was the iddah finished. He divorced her and he never took her back in the time that he could have taken her back. So the iddah finished, and then now men started to come for the sister. And then the ex-husband heard, and now he got jealous. So he came running, and he came to her brother. And then he said to her, marry me off to your sister. And she wanted her ex-husband. She doesn't know who these guys are coming. She knows her ex-husband. So what happened? He said, wallahi, I'm not going to marry you off to her. I told you this. Go, leave me. Then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala rebuked Ma'qal ibn Yasar for this. Allah rebuked Ma'qal ibn Yasar for this action of not marrying her off to his sister. The question here is, Allah said, don't stop them from marrying the man that they want and become an obstacle between her and the man. Allah is rebuking the guardian, Ma'qal. If she could marry without the permission of her wali, Allah wouldn't have to speak to Ma'qal ibn Yasar. She could have just went and married. So So the guardian is there to marry the woman off based on who she wants and if this person is good for her. He shouldn't use the guardian as a form to what? Abuse the girl. That's not why it was given to him. If the girl brings a guy, he goes good qualities, religion, deen, everything is there. He shouldn't say no. He should not what? He should not say no. Because if you do, وَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا تَكُنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ فِتْنَةٌ وَفَسَادٌ عَرِيضٌ. Great calamities and great problems will come from this. Pay attention to that. So any woman who does that, gets married without a wali, or the man does it without a wali, then this nikah is batil. You don't need to divorce her, by the way. When you find out that this nikah is not right, what do? Just go separate ways. And I remember there was a situation like that, where we had to tell a people who were married for 32 years. We said this nikah was batil, because the father wasn't asked. So we separated them. And then we said, go separate ways. And then we said to the husband, if you want now, we can do a new nikah for you. The woman said, Alhamdulillah, Allah saved me. I don't want him. Tell him to leave me alone. Allah saved me. 32 years I was with him. She said, no, don't marry him off to me. It was ajeeb. And he was saying, why? She said, this was a sign why Allah wanted me to leave you. So yes, it's her choice now. It's something new. If she wants to consider it, wa ma ila dhalik. Are we all together? فَنِكَاحُهَا بَاطِلٌ فَنِكَاحُهَا بَاطِلٌ فَإِنْ دَخَلَ بِهَا. What about if he had intimacy with her? We told them to go separate ways. But what about the mehr? Huh? The mehr here is what? Not what they stated. That's null and void. That's null and void. فَإِنْ دَخَلَ بِهَا. Then the mehr is called مَهْرُ الْمِثْلِ. It's called what? مَهْرُ الْمِثْلِ. مَهْرُ الْمِثْلِ means what? The women of her time, 32 years ago, how were the women and what were they married? What was the equivalent and what was it? That's what's given to her. No man can have intimacy with a woman and not pay her. Shara'an, it's not permissible. Are we together? فَإِنْ اِسْتَجَرُوا فَالسُّلْطَانُ وَلِيُّ مَنْ لَا وَلِيَ لَهُ. If the woman doesn't have no guardian, no person, then the guardian is in the hands of what? An imam or a qadi. Somebody takes the control of that issue. For example, she's a new Muslim. وما إلى ذلك. وعن حسين بن محسن قال حدثتني عمتي قالت أتيت النبي. حسين بن محسن, he said that his paternal aunt came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم for something and he dealt with her need. في بعض الحاجة فقال أي هذه أذاة بعل أنت. Then he, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, said, do you have a husband? He asked her, do you have a husband? She said, yes. He said, how are you with him? كيف أنت له? How are you towards him? قالت, she said, ما آله. I do not shorten. إلا ما عجزت عنه. I am not a person who holds back. I do everything I can for my husband. Unless when I'm unable to do something. قالت, then the messenger said to her, فأين أنت منه? Where you are from him? فإنما هو جنتك وناروك. He's your jannah and your nar. Be careful. This is what the path to Jannah or the path to the hellfire. وعن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله تعالى عنه قال قال رسول الله, the messenger said, إن من أشر الناس, the worst of people is, عند الله منزلة, in the eyes of Allah, is يوم القيامة, the day of judgment, الرجل, a man, يفضي إلى امرأته, has an intimate relationship with his wife, وتفضي إليه, and she has an intimate relationship with him, and then what do? They both talk about the intimate relationship to their friends or other people. ثم ينشر سرها. He talks about his wife. Other wife talks about her husband. These are the worst people in the eyes of Allah. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. It's very common. This is very, very common that people do this. They speak about their private life. إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. إلى هذا الحد. You have no secret. Your life is out there. People are talking about it. You only think you told one person or two people. 11 people know. One and one is what? 11. You think you told three people. 111 people know. The world's talking about you. Wallahi, it's khabith, it's filthiness that a person talks about their private life. This is your wife. And a wife's talking about her husband. You see, I'll tell you, brothers and sisters, something. If you and your wife are together, and there's a conflict between the two of you, don't tell anyone. Keep it to yourselves. If you do tell anyone, let it be a time when you're going separate ways. That's my policy. Why do I say that? Because you both might have a conflict, and you go to your parents, for example, either the father's side or the mother's side, and then you make up later because you both know it was a trivial issue, like the mother hasn't forgotten. She's like, this girl has destroyed my son. Or the girl's parents are saying, this guy is causing my daughter problems. But you both knew that you took it out of proportion when you were talking because you were angry that day, you were frustrated. But you really know that that's not what your husband's like. And your husband know that really this is not how your wife is really like. The day you come to your parents, let it be a time when you are going separate ways. That what you have to say is going to be the last thing you say. Before that, be strong enough to solve your own problems. Are we all together? Because wallahi, I've seen this myself. The more people that get their hands into your relationship, you guys are not controlling anything. It reaches a point, subhanAllah, sometimes, where the husband can't talk to his wife, he has to go through a wasita, a chain of narration. Ajib. He has to say, look, talk to her sister, and she's like, okay, I'll tell, that's my wife. Doesn't that happen? Why did that happen in the first place? If you what? Sahih? If you locked your lips and you don't talk, be quiet. Don't let people talk about your life. Don't let people speak about your issues. Remember, your tongue and your teeth are the closest and you bite yourself. Hada hada, no problem. You're the two closest people, you're going to bite yourself. Are we all together? This is going to happen. خَيْرُ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ Muhammad ibn Abdullah, 29 nights he had to boycott all of his wives. You guys know that famous hadith? 29 nights he boycotted all of his wife. He left them, frustrated, upset. I'm not going to go into that now. It's another hadith. But the point is, it happened. It happened to him. So don't think there's something, no, this is, it will happen. And I want you to all remember something. You both grew up in two different households. Two different lifestyles. Of course you're going to see things different sometimes. As long as, before I go into that, you both have grown up in two different environments, two different mindsets, two different households. Some of you, this family will say the cup is half full and this one will say half empty. None of you guys can say what you were raised up is the deen. It's not. It's culture. It's what? It's the way your parents saw it, they've raised you. And this one, none of your sides have a qalallah for everything they said. Does that make sense? So be tolerant. Even sometimes, just because you grew up like this doesn't mean it's always right. Open your mind and say, maybe I should try something new. Are you together? Muawiyah was asked, how do you govern these people for this long? You were strong. Muawiyah governed powerfully. How did you do it? He said, I saw it as though I had a rope between me and the people. When they pulled, I let go. And when they let go, I pulled. That's a marriage. Both people cannot let pull. It's going to snap in the middle. If you see a problem in your spouse, I can reassure you there's thousands of other good things that she has. And if you complain about your... Sometimes a sister calls me, she asks me a question. My husband's this, this, this. And I say to sister, wallahi, that's me you're describing. Sidqan. We're all like this. Sister, who are you looking for? That's the waqi' that we're all... Are we all together? It's the truth. Every household has the same problem. Don't let no one fool you. We're all the same. We're all going through the same problems. Are we all together? We just have different ways of responding to the issue. Are we all together? And how we control the situation. And we don't let it go bigger. Are we all together, brothers? And this is very important. So just this perception that the marriage has to be good every day. It's going to have downs. It's going to go up. It's going to tolerance. There's times, wallah, you're going to laugh about your mistake or what you just did. How silly were we to do this? And how... But the point is, be open-minded that not necessarily everything you've been cultivated is right. It's not always right. And not everything you were told, it's this, is not always the case. If it's issue related to the religion, nah, don't compromise. Deenullahi, I can't. But if it's, this should be done like this and not like this, okay, let me take things from you, you take things from me. If you come with that mindset, inshallah ta'ala, there will come a lot of good from it. Al-Hadith al-Arba'un, the 40th Hadith. وعن أم سلمة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت دخل علي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعندي مخنث. أم سلمة, she said, دخل علي النبي, the messenger entered onto me, وعندي مخنث, and there was a مخنث. مخنث is a man who's a what? He, she. What's a good way of saying it? Like the thing with these, all these terms, transsexual, what do you call it? She, he, she, what's the, I don't know, she, male, all these, I don't know how, which one is which. I've got confused at the end. The point is, male and female. So he has these tendencies. Because the Arab, the word mukhannath, it means all of those words can be it. فَسَمِعْتُ يَقُولُ لِعَبْدِلَّهِ بْنِ أَبِي أُمَيَّةِ. I heard him say to Abdullah ibn Abi Umayyah, يَا عَبْدِلَّهِ أرأيت إن الله إن فتح الله عليك الطائف غدا فعليك بابنة غيلان. The مخنث is talking. He said, if Allah تبارك وتعالى tomorrow allows Taif to be conquered, then upon you is what? Huh? The daughter of غيلان. Why? فإن تقبل بأربع, she comes forward with four, and وتدبر بثمان, and with eight, meaning he was able to describe her. He knew some secrets about the women. He was sitting with the women, but he was looking, meaning there was shahwa in him, towards men's side. So he was talking about things. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Umm Salama, لا يدخلن هؤلاء عليكن. Don't let these type of people come into you, because they know what's happening. And that's another issue. Sometimes there's boys who are big and they're sitting with women. And the mother is like, no, he's a little kid, he doesn't know what's happening. He knows everything that's taking place. So this is dangerous. This is dangerous. Be careful. Al-Hadith al-Hadi wal-Arba'una, the 41 Hadith. وعن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه قال لعن الله, may Allah's curse be upon, الواشمات والمتشمات والمتنمصات والمتفلجات للحسن المغيرات خلق الله. May Allah's curse be upon who? The ladies who practice al-washimat, tattoo. The women who do tattoo on themselves. They are cursed. And the men, of course. The ones who do tattoo are cursed. Okay? Tattoos were present at that time. Are we all together? But if somebody done it before Islam, and they've got it on them, or before they started practicing the religion, they've got it on them, it's not obligatory to get rid of it. It's not necessary. It's not obligatory. It's not. لِأَنَّ الضَّرَرَ is hard. The harm that comes from trying to remove it is hard. Like in some of them, subhanAllah, when you're in da'wah and you're the imam of a masjid and these issues come to you. I remember one man, he had a tattoo of a naked woman on him. Are you with me? And another one, a cross, Christian, salib, on his arm. وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ عَجِيب. You can't, what can you do? And this harms the skin. Cancer, skin cancer, even if it goes, it's still something still there. The money you have to pay, subhanAllah, is too much. These things, they need fatwa from the ulama. It needs to be revised and looked at, because it's a big issue. لَعَنَ اللَّهُ, may Allah's curse be upon, الْوَاشِمَاتِ, there are people who are practicing tattoo, who are placing tattoo on themselves. So the ones who are doing it and the ones who are practicing both are cursed. The one who's doing it does it for the people. He doesn't do it for himself, but he does it to people. And the other one who's doing it for him. والمتنمصات. متنمصات are those who pluck the eyebrows. What falls under the plucking of the eyebrows, Sheikh Salah Al-Fawzan mentioned, is the women who bleach their eyebrows and then write a pen on it. They didn't cut their hair. What do? They bleach it, then it becomes the hair becomes the color of the skin. So you can't see the hair on the eyebrows. You can't see it. And then they take a little pen. This is what she does. Sheikh Salih Al-Fawzan said it's the same. It's the same. وَالْمُتَنَمِّصَاتِ, she's plucking her eyebrows, she's cursed. وَالْمُتَفَلِّجَاتِ, مُتَفَلِّجَاتِ were women who used to, they used to make a little space between their teeth. That was a beauty at that time. And it changes over time. chip their teeth. There was a time in history when they used to just little chip their teeth to make it beauty. All of those is impermissible. Can a person change the way Allah created them? Yeah? A woman cannot change the way Allah created her. She can't. But what about if the woman is so she can't do plastic surgery on herself or not. She can't do that. Lakin, if a woman has had a lot of children and her body has changed, the strongest opinion is that if she wants to bring it back to how it was before, then this is not falling under وَلَا يُغَيِّرُنَّ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ. It doesn't fall under that. الثاني والأربعون وعن أمي حبيبة أم المؤمنين رضي الله عنها قال she said سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم she heard the messenger of Allah يقول saying لا يحل لامرأة it is not permissible for a woman تؤمن بالله who believes in Allah واليوم الآخر and the day of judgment أن تحد على ميت that she wails and mourns for over three إلا على زوج except her husband. Except for what? For her husband. A woman is not allowed to mourn over 3 days. Except for her husband. فَإِنَّا تُحِدُّ عَلَيْهِ أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ وَعَشْرًا She can wail and mourn, not wail, but mourn, feel sad. For how much? 4 months and what? 10 days, which is the عِدَّة for the woman who loses her husband. And I have to mention the issue of عِدَّة, which is that the woman, if her husband dies, how long is her عِدَّة? Yeah? How much? 4 months and 10. What about if she's divorced? Huh? 3. Who said shuhur? It's not shuhur. Quru. It's 3 menstruation or 3 purification? As a mas'ala khilafiyya, we'll leave that for another time. Whether it's 3 menstruation she has to count or 3 purification she has to count, that's a difference of opinion. But I want to say something. If her husband divorces his wife, because this is a big issue, wallahi. I had a case one time, a woman came to me. She got divorced by her husband. Idda didn't finish, she got married to another one. Second husband. The idda didn't finish. Then he divorced her. Without the idda finished for the second one, she married a third one. He divorced, they went separate ways. And then idda, she married the fourth one. She's on her fourth one now, she comes to me. I said to her, you and this man separate, go separate ways. You have to, all the idda you missed, you bring it now. Every single idda that you missed, the 3 months, how many? 3, 6, 9, right? All of them you have to bring. And guess what? Your first husband, if he wants to take you back, he can take you back. The idda wasn't counted. Dangerous. It's a detailed, dangerous matter. Are we all together, brothers? Each idda is ta'abudi. You need to come with it. And if your first husband finds out that you're counting the first idda, what is he going to do? He's got the time, he's got the chance to say, Raja'atu, I come back from it. Fah. And if he wants, he can take you back. And if he doesn't take you back, the second one hears that you're doing the idda for him, what can you do? It can take you back. Are we all together, brothers? Another issue that you find is that a man divorces his wife. He divorces his wife and they go separate ways. And this was the last divorce. At-talaqu marratani. He divorced her the third time, it's all over, finished. So what does he do to her? He says to her, go and what? Go and marry somebody else. Go get married. They call the sheikh and they say, sheikh, this is what happened. Okay, that's a divorce, sister. I can't do nothing for you, brother. It is a divorce. It happened. They go separate ways. He tells her, okay, you know what, go get married. When she gets married to another man, shar'an there has to be intimacy for the other man that she's going to get married to. Are we all together? He has to. And she has to marry that other man with a will that she wants to be with him. She cannot do it because she wants to come back to the first. Why? This would be zina with this one, and if she comes back to this one, it's zina with this one. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah wrote a kitab on it, Bayanu al-Dalil fi Butlan al-Tahlil. Are we all together? These are issues that are taken very lightly. Very, very lightly. Are we all together? ولذلك a situation came one time, a woman did that. She, her and her husband agreed. He said, okay, I got a brother, you can get married, to go get married to him. A'udhu billah. How does he even feel? But he told her, she said, okay. She went and she got married. When she got married, she said, I'm going to stay with this one. Sorry, I don't want to come back to you. He got angry, he came to me. He came angry, he said, this is what she did, we had an agreement. I said, first of all, she's not married to that one. The one she went to, was it an agreement for both of you? Ha, no, she's not married to him. She needs to leave him, number one. Are we all together? Nothing here, what she's doing is zina. She has, if she wants him, now she can get married to him. He said, but what about me? I said, that's between you two. And I can't force her into it. Are we all together? That's important that these, nowadays people are taking money out of the people. There's a website they made for this. There's men who are registered, they do this for women. Do you guys hear it? There's a website they made for it. لا يجوز. It's not permissible. We need to fear Allah Azza wa Jalla. These things, you see, people just want to make money out of people. All of it was, if they just followed the what? The ahkam of the sharia, it would have all been good. I guess you guys learned a lot today. Things that impressed you and that was good for you and that was in favor for your lifestyle and things that what? That upset you, right? هذا دين الله. Everyone here knows their life and their situation. بَلِ الْإِنسَانُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ بَصِيرًا وَلَوْ أَلْقَى مَعَاذِيرًا. All I want to say to all of you is, the family is the heart of the society. The household, I mean, is the heart of the society. If our wives and children and husbands are all good, we will live a good life. Let's fear Allah in all of our affairs. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala perfect our marriages, our lifestyle, our children, our household. If I offended anyone in what I said, that was not my intent. I did not intend to do that.